the smoke radio for the masses.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
If the game is rigged, change the game.
Game changer.
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
This is Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
I need your help to get to the year 1985.
Listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
What up, what up? It's Fade to Black, it's Monday. How you doing? Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today's Monday, October 5th, 278 days into the new year, just 87 days left. We are live from the City of Angels Studios right here in rainy, it's raining outside Burbank, California. COA Vapor, the makers of the Fade to Black e-juice, and it's called Fader Loops. Just go to the COA banner at jimmychurchradio.com. You can use the promo code JIMMYLIVE for the Fade or Not special. Let's do this. I'd like to welcome everybody listening all around the world, all across the United States, hither and thither, to and fro, back and forth, up and down, east and west, far and near. This is Fade to Black. For KJCR and the Game Changer Network and KGRA, the planets. I'm your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. What is cracking, everybody? I hope everybody had a great weekend. Yes, I'm back in the chair. It's finally cooled off here at the gates of hell, which is Southern California. The thought of turning on the heater at the house actually crossed my mind last night. But as hot as it was this summer, I swear on all that is holy, I made a commitment to myself. It can never get that cold. It just can't. Not turning on the heater this year. I don't care how much the kids complain. That's it, man. It was just too hot. Too hot. Feels good. Windows are open, it's raining, it smells good, and there you go. I think winter is finally here. Watch, you know, we're in October, we'll probably blast another bucko 5 day here before it's all said and done, but I think we've taken the turn. All right, I am excited because tonight we have back with us Dr. Heather Lynn, Renegade Archaeologist. She is back with us. She'll be right here in the batter's box in about 25 minutes. And tomorrow night, a very, very special doubleheader tomorrow night. We'll have Joshua P. Warren on and his analysis of the White House ghost photo. And so we'll be doing that tomorrow night in the first segment. Second segment, Jay Widener. Yes, the Jay Widener is back with us. And it's been a while since Jay has been on the show, and Joshua. So that's a doubleheader tomorrow night. It's going to be exciting. And then Wednesday, we have Alex Teplish on the show. And he's got a new book, which I have here, and I've read it. It's called The Epic of the Anunnaki. And it's an illustrated novel. It's really well done, and everybody's in this. Pretty cool. It's a pretty cool book. So I have it here. I've read it, and Alex will be with us on Wednesday. Tonight, I do want to allow all of you Fade or Nots the opportunity to pop some questions off to Dr. Heather Lynn. So we'll open up the phones at the top of the hour, third hour of the show tonight, 323-825-5045. So get your questions ready. Make them smart. Make me look good, you fade or not. And I'll say this. Heather dropped me an email over the weekend. So excited. Get to come back and hang out with the Fader Knots. So Heather is an official Fader Knot. She is. Oh, man, she's been with us since I don't even know when she was on with us the first time. It's been a while, and she's back, and she's fired up. So everybody in Twitter tonight, just fire off a nice welcome back to the show, family welcome tweet to Dr. Heather Lynn. All right. We have got, I wanted to say really quick, right before the show, got a special delivery. So I just want to say that, I got a birthday present from Deborah. Thank you, Deborah. She sent me, I'm just going to say it was a birthday present, which I wasn't supposed to open until this Saturday. Screw it. You know, it's, I couldn't help myself. I knew it was something cool, and I knew it. And she sent me a Mustang t-shirt, and it is cool. Thank you. It's in the right color, too, black. And thank you, Deborah. Very cool. And I just want, you know, that is so personal that it's cool. And she sent me in the card, she wrote, "What other Fader Knot got you a Mustang for your birthday?" The answer is none. Thank you, Deborah. Very cool. I know that you picked that out special. And so let's see, I got that out of the way. Wanted to make another announcement. We have, I know some of this feels like it's premature, but it's not. We have 3, 4, or 5 conferences coming up, and they're all back-to-back. They feel that way, at least. And let's see. First up on the calendar will be the Skyfire Summit, which is Travis Walton's. That's coming up in a month. So that's November 5th through the 8th. Go to skyfiresummit.com. Get your tickets and info. Speakers at that one will be Travis Walton, David Hatcher Childress, Dr. Leo Sprinkle, Lee Spiegel, Tracy Torme, Ben Hansen, James Fox, Lynn Kitai, Jennifer Stein, No Torres, Alejandro, and Paula Harris will all be there. And that is in Heber, Arizona. I know that Race Hobbs and the KGRA crew will be there too, broadcasting from the event. And if we can pull it off, we are going to attend as well. So we'll know a little bit more about that, but Race will be there and the KGRA crew broadcasting from the event. And there's a couple of other events we're confirming, so I don't want to announce those right now. But Alien Snowfest is confirmed. That is February 5th through the 7th in Big Bear. You can go to, you know, that's George. George is going to be there, Linda. Moulton Howe, Jason Martell, Stanton Friedman, Micah Hanks, Mike Barrow, Richard Dolan, myself. That is a solid, solid lineup too as well. That is a great event. That is there. And then right after that, a week later, is the 14th annual Conscious Life Expo. And that is February 19th through the 22nd right here in Los Angeles, California. That's at the LAX Hilton. Also, George Norrie, David Wilcock, Sean Stone, Dean Ryan, Linda Moulton Howe again, William Henry, Mike Barrett, Jason Martell, Serena Wright Taylor, Robert Perala, myself. We're going to broadcast that Friday night. We are going to do a very special Fade to Black live broadcast for the opening ceremonies that evening and in the main room there. So right after they do the opening ceremonies, boom, we're going to turn around right there on the same stage, and we are going to broadcast Fade to Black. And we're going to do it Fade to Black style. We're going to have 45 speakers in 2 hours, 3 minutes each. That's what we're going to do. I can't wait. And then I think the next day, on Saturday, George Norrie is going to have his meet and greet. So we will be there for that. And then it's either that day or the next day, I'm not too sure, the Ancient Aliens panel. And I will be hosting that panel. So it's going to be great. And then right after that, we are so solidly booked up. Right after that comes Contact in the Desert. So, yeah, crazy, crazy 5-6 months that we have up in front of us. But it's a great opportunity to get out there and meet all of you Fader Knots. All right. Next, I want to announce Studio Dome over the weekend. Decided to do an extra special Fader Knot special on the SBB boom box. They dropped the price another $10 down to $49 for the SBB. You still get the Buddy 4 port USB charger for free. You get free shipping. Just use the promo code Jimmy. $49. That's $49 free shipping. A Buddy thrown in the box. Just use the promo code Jimmy. It's all on the banner right now at jimmychurchradio.com. And so there you go. All right. So, again, Studio Dome loves the Fader Knots and all of the support. If you did go back, anything that you purchased for $59 over the last week, boom, they'll take care of you. Okay? It's $10 if you want it. Let's get the show cracking. We got to go. We got a lot of stuff to cover tonight. Today, AC/DC frontman Brian Johnson is 68 years old. Where did life go? Where did it go so fast that Brian Johnson is 68 years old? Neil deGrasse Tyson today, 57. Love him or hate him, don't go there. Still a smart guy, 57 years old. Bob Geldof. That's right, up all night. Bob Geldof is 64. Went from the Boomtown Rats to like the richest guy in the United Kingdom. I think he's a knight now, isn't he? Isn't he Sir Bob Geldof? 64 years old. And Steve Miller, fly like an eagle. Steve Miller is 72. Holy crap. I had to go back and double check that, but he is 72 years old today, still going strong. Steve Miller, our dead guy's birthday today. Moment of silence for Bernie Mac, 1957 to 2008, died at the age of 50. One of the funniest, most original comics ever. That's my writing. Teamed up with Steve Harvey, D.L. Hughley, Cedric the Entertainer to film the original Kings of Comedy back in 2000 and changed the comedy world forever. In 2008, Mac was admitted to Northwestern Memorial Hospital in Chicago. After a week of unsuccessful medical treatment, Mac went into cardiac arrest and died during the early morning hours of August 9th from complications of pneumonia. Happy birthday, Bernie Mac. You're a funny dude. And so let's light it up on Twitter. Right now, let's do it for Bernie Mac. What's your favorite Bernie Mac movie? What's your favorite? I have, I'll help you out here just a little bit. I listed a few of my favorites. I think everybody knows my favorite. But you got Friday, The Players Club, Ocean's 11, 12, 13, Bad Santa. That was pretty brilliant, epic. Charlie's Angels, played Bosley. Mr. 3000, Soul Man. How about his last performance in Old Dogs? Happy birthday, Bernie Mac. Let me know on Twitter, at JChurchRadio. This is Fade to Black. Tonight, Dr. Heather Lynn is with us on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. We'll be back right after this short break. Stay with us.
You're listening to Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Fade to Black will now pause for alien identification.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444. Or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
9 out of 10 geneticists agree.
Fade to Black is not your father's radio show on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the planet.
Hi, this is Chase Kletsky with Fate Magazine Radio, and you're listening to Jimmy Church and Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA digital broadcast station, where the Fader Knots rock.
Hi, this is Rob Reiner from Anvil, and you're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? I'm Chris.
What up? This is Kyle Massey, and you're listening to Jimmy Church Radio.
Fade to Black. I'm telling you right now, the Fader Knots, this family, this audience just makes this show special. And just goes to show you, they appreciate good humor too. Because everybody's got a Bernie Mac movie. The word of the month is still spoon. I want to thank Tammy and Mark too, by the way. Got another package in the mail from them yesterday. Some spoon molds. Yeah, I'm not kidding either. More on that as that story develops. Tonight, we have very special guest, Dr. Heather Lynn, with us, the Renegade Archaeologist. She is hanging out in the sandbox. If you want to come over and hang out with all of us, just at J Church Radio. Simple. That's all you got to do. Hashtag F2B, sandbox, boom, come hang out in real time. Throughout the show tonight. On this day in history, in 1969, a Cuban defector lands a Russian MiG in Miami. In an embarrassing breach of the United States air defense capability, too, by the way. The Cuban pilot enters U.S. airspace undetected. Yep. Yeah. And lands his Soviet-made MiG-17 at Homestead Air Force Base. Just south of Miami in Florida. Fader facts. This will creep you out. That's why you come to the show, right? Get freaked out, creeped out. Ugh. Just one person in a room adds 37 million bacteria to the air every hour. Think about that the next time you're on a plane. All right. We're going to be talking to Dr. Heather Lynn about this in just a few minutes. ISIS militants have destroyed the iconic Arch of Triumph in Palmyra. Yes, blew it up. It's the latest cultural treasure of the ancient site that they have reduced to rubble. A couple of days ago, I happened to be on this website. And I'm following these, the author, his photographs. It was from Travel Magazine, and then it made its way to another website. But it was just an incredible article with photographs. And I'm looking at the Triumph, and I was staring at it. And as soon as I saw Palmyra, I knew it was just going to be rubble here soon. And then boom, 2 days later, ISIS. Unbelievable. The 1,800-year-old monumental arch, which framed the approach of the Roman city, was blown up this past Sunday. And ISIS jihadists seized control of Palmyra, the UNESCO World Heritage Site, and its surrounding area from the Syrian government, from their forces back in May. Since then, the extremists have beheaded the antiquities expert because he wouldn't tell them about where other stuff was. So they chopped his head off, and they just set about blowing stuff up. And the question is, when do we put our foot down? When do we say enough is enough? Seriously. I mean, this is stuff that can never be replaced. It goes without saying. I don't want to sound juvenile here. But when do we... That entire area, Syria and Iraq, you know, if you think about it, Jordan, Petra, you know, there's no issues in Jordan yet. But if you think about that entire area, Turkey, it's the cradle of civilization. And it's being leveled. You know, and there's so much there that we haven't discovered. The stuff that we have discovered is one thing. There's everything there that we haven't. And we'll be talking to Dr. Heather Lynn about all of that. New maps of Syria were released today. And if you haven't, all of these articles that I'm talking about right now, they're all posted over on our Facebook page, Jimmy Church Radio. If you want to go follow up, you can do that there. And pictures and so forth. New maps of Syria show the mysterious bright spots and the huge pyramid-shaped mountain in a new light in 3D. You need to go and check this out. The new maps of Syria come courtesy of NASA's Dawn spacecraft, which has been orbiting the heavily cratered dwarf planet since March. The maps highlight the compositional and evolution differences across Syria. So when you look at this, and you have to remember, Syria is the largest object in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Significant. And these 3D reliefs and the way that they've mapped it, it's going to change things. And they intentionally, so if you go over to Jimmy Church Radio and check it out, you'll see they intentionally focused on the bright spots. Go and look. And the mountain, the pyramid. Go and check it out. Well, it happened. General Mills is recalling 1.8 million boxes of Cheerios that were labeled gluten-free that actually contain wheat. The company said in a press release today that issues offloading flour at its facility in Lodi, California, may have caused the contamination. And it affects 4 days' worth of the factory's production. General Mills ordered boxes still at warehouses and on store shelves to be returned and is asking customers with wheat allergies to call the company directly. The company is in the process of converting 5 Cheerios varieties to gluten-free. And this recall affects Honey Nut Cheerios and the classic Cheerios in the yellow box. Wheat, gluten. You know, is gluten? I'm gonna throw this over because I'm not allergic to wheat. Well, I should be after Richard Allen Miller's show the other night, but I'm gonna divert this to our Twitter audience. Gluten and this gluten allergy, has it been there throughout history? I don't remember hearing about this growing up. Or even in the, you know, it's new over the last 5 years. Is this, I don't know. And every time I try to talk to people about it and try to find out what it is, it's ambiguous, the answers. And I know I'm not trying to say that it's ambiguous. I'm saying that I can't get anything solid on it. I'm going to have to go do some research. Maybe I'm allergic and I've never known. I've never let wheat. You know, and I always thought that things like wheat thins, I always thought that gluten was good for you. Wheat bread. I just don't get it. Just wheat English muffins. I don't know. All right. A unique petroglyph Now, this also is over on our Facebook page, and this is extraordinary. I'm going to talk to Heather about this, too. It's a great day to have Dr. Heather Lynn on the show, because this petroglyph was discovered near the Atlantic coast of northern Spain and has provided evidence that contacts between ancient Atlantic cultures and the Mediterranean were earlier and perhaps more intense than previously thought. This is a rock art panel. It's located in Costa dos Castros, and also known as Agua dos Cibros, depicts a boat with a structure, including a combination of oars and sails that match the general design and concept of everything that was coming out of the Mediterranean roughly 4,000, 5,000 years ago. A typical Atlantic equivalent boats of the time were oar-propelled. Okay, without sails. So now we have this on a cave wall. How did they see it? This is on the Atlantic side of Spain. Think about this for a second. Changes everything, doesn't it? Go and check out. You can see the petroglyph over at Jimmy Church Radio, our Facebook page. It is right there. Oh, man, we are done. I've got a couple of other things I needed to get in here tonight. Let me go to the good stuff. Okay. Are you ready? Are you sitting down? An Ohio couple suspected of robbing a bank proved to be their own worst enemies as they posted pictures on social media posing with cash. John E. Mogan II of Pataskala, Ohio, entered the savings bank in Asheville, Ohio on August 24th, handed the teller a note. The teller handed him an undisclosed amount of cash, and Mogan fled on foot, according to the Pickaway County Sheriff's Office and the Asheville Police Department. Authorities said that after they identified Mogan as a suspect, they came across Facebook photos of him posing with cash. One photo shows Mogan with a wad of bills stuffed in his mouth. I've seen the pictures. It's insane. His girlfriend, Ashley K. Dubow, 24, was also charged on the September 21st for taking part in the alleged robbery. Now, listen, note to self. This is Fade to Black. I'm going to get out of here. Let's do this. Tonight, Dr. Heather Lynn is with us. We've got a great week in front of us. Tomorrow night, Joshua P. Warren right here in the house. And then followed by Jay Widener, yes, in the same night. And then Wednesday, Alex Teplish, the Epic of the Anunnaki. It's a great week here on Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. I'll be back with Dr. Heather Lynn right after this short break. Stay with us.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Hakimi, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Hi, this is Jimmy Church of Fade to Black. Today, everybody, the Fader Knots, and planet Earth is vaping. And I'm very proud to announce our very own e-juice. When we were approached by City of Angels Vapor about Fade to Black e-juice, I wanted to make sure that it was the very best and that the flavors were something that I could create myself. And we did just that. Introducing Fade to Black Fader Loops. This will take you right back to Saturday morning cartoons and your favorite bowl of fruity, loopy cereal. Just click on the banner or go to www.coavapor.com. Enter the promo code Jimmy for the Fader Knot special. That's www.coavapor.com. Go Beckley Tappy.
Hi, this is Ray Sobbs here, repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you. And your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
Yes.
We're of the Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
All right, you fader knots. Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fader Knot special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52mm main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $59.99 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. That's 70% off a list price of $199.99, and they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net anywhere. Just go to jimmychurchradio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black. Across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
All right, welcome back, Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Network and KTRA, the planet tonight. Dr. Heather Lynn is back with us. We have so much to talk about, changes all over the planet. And tomorrow night, Joshua P. Warren's going to be here with his White House ghost photo image analysis. Also, Jay Widener tomorrow night. And then Wednesday, Alex Teplish and his new book, The Epic of the Anunnaki. But tonight, it's Dr. Heather Lynn. Heather Lynn is a writer, a historian, and renegade archaeologist. She broke away from the mainstream after realizing that much of what we know about our history is based solely on the consensus of the elite, often politically motivated individuals and institutions. Now, Heather is on a quest to expose the intricate network of corrupt academic elites, global power brokers, and international banking families that work together to revise human history. Please ask Dr. Heather to tell us all of it tonight. We're going to open up the phone lines at the top of the hour, and I would like to welcome back to the show Dr. Heather Lynn. Doctor, are you with us?
I am. How are you?
I am fantastic. Thank you. It's great to hear your voice, and welcome back to the show. We have so much. Have you ever seen the Fader Knots this excited about a guest?
Well, I have to say I'm very humbled. Thank you so much. It's really great to be back, and I'm so excited because you and your listeners, the Fader Knots, I swear, it just sounds like I'm blowing smoke up your, you know, but it's not true. The most awakened group of people out there, period.
It's amazing how smart they are, really.
Yeah.
You know what's really, I'll say this now, and I'll be honest. If I get stuck, I just divert. I divert it over to them. That's what I do. And I'll get the answer within seconds. It's so funny how that works, but it's true. They are just so smart, and they are starving to learn new things and challenge the status quo. And that's what we're here. That's why you're on this show, to be honest with you, because that's exactly what you do. And the last time that you were on, we went directly at Ur and Iraq and the connections. That was a harsh show too, wasn't it? All the way back into Northern Europe. But it was an eye-opening show for all of us. And I got so much feedback after the show from different listeners who had no idea that this was going on in the United States involvement and the power corrupt and the banking industry and how not only banking, but just industrial families in general are interfering with what is going on out there. And they have a reason for it too as well. It was just an enlightening but dark show at the same time. And I just got feedback forever. So now, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, you know, I also got a lot of feedback, and this is what has really instilled in my mind that the Fate or Nots are completely awakened, because like no other show, after I was on, my email blew up, and not just with the general, oh, you know, I enjoy the show or anything like that. I mean, I had some of that, but I'm telling you, what I really got was usable, interesting research leads and material. I mean, people just threw me things that blew my mind and sent me in different directions when I was writing the follow-up, and I'm just ever so grateful. In fact, I'm sure many people will see or at least recognize their names or the names of other Fate or Nots in the follow-up to the Sumerian Controversy, Land of the Watchers, because I've included a dedication page to all the people that sent me really awesome research leads, because I couldn't have done the follow-up without a lot of that. So thank you to Fate or Nots for being not only awakened, but active.
Well, you know what? I go through that every day, too. Now that you've experienced it, you need a 48-hour day. You know, yeah. 24, you know, because I get so much of that. And now, you know, I know you know exactly what I'm talking about. You have to, it takes time. It takes time to follow up on everything because it's all good. And each one takes you down another, you know, the proverbial rabbit hole. And that takes time. And it just, it snowballs and snowballs. I wish there was a 48-hour day. I would just be so happy. So now, since then, since you were on the show, so much has happened. It's crazy how
terrible.
And there's some good things too. We're going to touch upon that. But right now, when you see what's going on in Syria, and we'll talk about Palmyra here in a second, but when you see this, when you know what's going on in Iraq and you know it's out of control, we can't rope it in Syria, and it could very well bleed over into something else. How does it feel? I mean, I know it's helplessness, but we can never get the stuff back. And there's the part for me that it's the stuff we haven't discovered that is being destroyed.
Right. It is terrible. And, you know, somebody mentioned earlier a really good point, which is, you know, how do we know this is even happening? And I'm not going to sit here and say, well, you know, none of this is actually happening, because it certainly is. There's too much evidence that to show that, yes, these sites are being destroyed and people are being killed. But you have to also, you know, keep an open eye on this situation, because, you know, they have been known through history, but even in this situation with ISIS, to destroy, you know, relics that were made of plaster or different things that, you know, were replicas, and just to kind of do it for show. So we don't know what kind of propaganda we're getting, really. I mean, but I, you know, so it's really hard now because we can't actually go there. We're sitting here. So you talk about feeling helpless. My God, that is exactly what most people are going through right now. We're watching the just destruction of not just the culture of another country or, you know, another people, but ours. This is the where we came from. This is the cradle of civilization. This is our collective history, and to see it all just destroyed, I mean, there are no words. There are really no words, but it really makes me suspicious, too, when I see, you know, a lot of this. I think, you know, well, what's real and what's not, you know? So we just have to pay careful attention to the facts and really make sure we're investigating as much as we can, and know that there's always that, you know, grain of doubt, because we're not able to be there. And it's a very convenient position, you know, for the power brokers to have. It's just this sort of wall, this virtual wall between us, the media, and now the internet, and they can just post whatever. And there's so many things that have been coming out where, people have been showing ISIS beheadings that were actually maybe put in films and all this different stuff. I mean, there's conspiracies rampant. So I would say that we can't discount all of them. We certainly can't say it's all true. So again, all it does is it leaves us as the general public as spectators to all this, helpless spectators. And so how do we know it's true? How do we know it's not? We can only do our very best to do our research and, try to remain sensitive to this. This is the one thing that I would say is don't let apathy sink in. As helpless as we may feel, you cannot become apathetic and just start being desensitized to these images or these news stories, because once that happens, then what?
Yeah, exactly.
That's what they want.
Well, why is it that not only the United States, but it seems like all of the governments, all of the world is not doing anything about it? They're just allowing this to happen. Why? I don't understand that end game.
Well, yeah. I think there's a lot more to it than even, obviously what it appears. I mean, yes, archaeology, history, it's important to the mindset, to the identification of a culture. They look at these things as, important cultural symbols. So yes, you can argue, well, by destroying them, we can somehow, destroy their culture or whatnot. But, that argument, while it's completely valid, can only take you so far, because there has to be a limit then. Well, why are they putting so much money and effort into this? It's not cheap to put a bunch of people out here blowing things up in terms of the cost, human capital, all of this. So there's more motivation, I believe, behind this than simply we want to make some big symbolic gesture and show our power. I believe that is one factor, but I believe there's something else there too. And I don't know that we're really going to get the truth, but let's just say, I don't want to say I've become jaded by any means, but let's just say maybe I've become initiated in some way, because when I initially started this journey, I was really, I hate to admit it, but I think I was a lot more naive. And I start looking and going down this rabbit hole, and I find all these crazy connections. And, I wrote about it, and when I wrote about it in the Sumerian controversy, I really just was looking for something, looking for answers, looking for, what this could be. Well, afterwards, I've been slammed, like I said, with different leads, and some of them were, dead ends, and many of them were not. The ones that I thought would be just a loony, for lack of a better term, sometimes became the ones that seemed most plausible once I researched them further. I spoke with a lot of people and saw a lot of things that I can't unsee, and it's changed me. It's changed me. I can't tell you if it's changed me for the better, but it's definitely changed me. So now I have to say, in terms of who is actually behind this and what their motivations are, I am prepared to say that it is probably one of the world's biggest conspiracies, for lack of a better term.
Well, with Earth, it seemed we were prepared, and we did, put boots on the ground, literally. There was heavy influence that came out of, I don't want to, pinpoint things, but let's just say Northern Europe, okay?
Right.
And that was there. And then, Palmyra happens, and I don't understand why, different governments, it just in that area, didn't go out and surround that and go, look, if you want to do that, we'll fight over here, but not here. And they just seemed to let it happen, and mass media covered it. And everything still got blown up. They're so corrupt.
It's so corrupt over there. The tribalism, the different. I mean, they have government, but it's so corrupt. I'm telling you, it is unbelievably corrupt. So if for whatever reason they wanted to stage something, it just takes, you know, a song and a dollar and they'll do it. It's nothing. So we really can't even expect these people to stand up for it. Well, you know, on that note, though, let me just say this. I was a little disappointed. Recently, I've been getting some emails. Once I started posting some of this, you know, just the news about these sites and everything, I was surprised to get some emails from people who were saying they were almost supportive of this. And I mean, this is something I had never heard before, that, you know, the idea is that, oh, well, it's, you know, maybe this will make them wake up and realize, or maybe this is what they need, and, you know, we shouldn't be involved, et cetera. And, you know, while I agree that we should not be involved in any of these Middle East dealings, like you said, at what point do we stand up and say enough? You know, so I was surprised to see that, you know, there are some people out there that are almost rooting for this. And when you think about that, that's quite disturbing. There's a lot of disturbing factors involved in this.
Well, if you remember during the spring uprising in Egypt, the citizens surrounded the Cairo Museum and they were like, okay, mm-hmm. not here. You can go and take that trash.
That was beautiful.
And we don't see even that at all of these historical sites that are falling like dominoes in Syria mm-hmm. and Iraq. And that's the part that is shocking to me. We can only expect so much from the United States or Great Britain or France or whoever to go in there and do this. But the culture itself that lives there needs to stand up. And that's the part that I just find shocking to me, that they just let it happen and they're running and allowing this to happen. That's the part that I don't understand.
I think in terms of the, you know, the citizens at this point, I think they're just scared. You know, it's so easy to talk about these things, to say, you know, it's so, you know, it's not just, it's not fair, it's terrible. But, you know, at the end of the day, what people generally want universally, if they're asked, they just want safety, security, family. They just want to live their lives in peace. Even if they have a real strong passion about this, they still, at the end of the day, are looking to take care of themselves and their family, rightfully so. So it's a tough call, because, you know, the citizens, it's very brave for the Egyptians to, you know, encompass their, you know, museums and precious sites. But, you know, there's... Some people just can't necessarily get up to do that, so it's tough. I don't think that it's their fault so much as it is just this government involvement. We're fighting a proxy war. It's as simple as that. It's as simple as that. Yet it's as complicated as, like, well, then why? What is this over? And I still, you know, there's a lot of things that it's over. But, you know, the one that you hear a lot of is, oh, it's the oil. It's the oil. Well, you know, that's an interesting idea, too. Not all these places obviously have oil, so it's not all about oil. But I did find something recently in my research I was doing for Land of the Watchers about oil itself and the history of oil and how the Sumerians actually valued oil as much as gold. And so they were working on a petrodollar even then.
Right.
So I find that to be quite interesting.
That is interesting. One of the websites that you turned me on to is Ancient History, etc. And I'm trying to think. It's etc.ancient.eu. That's the website. And if you go... I'm just going to tell the audience, if you go to our Facebook page for Jimmy Church Radio and scroll down and look at the Epic of Gilgamesh article that is there, that'll take you over to Ancient History, etc. It's an amazing website.
It's a great website.
Oh, man. And I spent so much time there. And not only the reading is good, but the photography, they take such care about how things are represented, and I really dig that. So anyway, Ancient History, etc. And you had published earlier on your website this article, the newly discovered Tablet 5 of the Epic of Gilgamesh. And I went over and read the entire article, and I was blown away. There's so many things about this story that are intriguing. It's a real eye-opener. And I want you to kind of take me through it, because we're going to discuss it more in depth right after the break. But let's talk about Tablet 5. First off, the best part about it is, how was it discovered?
Well, yeah, that is the best part. Well, for one thing, they don't know where it came from, really, because it was bought by smugglers. So it was already a sort of a black market, shady deal, which I find to be, you know, fascinating in and of itself. What other things, you know, were lost maybe in that deal? This is something that happens a lot more than anybody even wants to accept. A lot of the legitimate pieces that are housed in museums today have been bought off the black market, or sometimes stolen, a lot of times stolen. You know, but institutions want to keep their, you know, credibility high by acting like, well, they're preserving it and they're this and that, and they are. But don't let that exterior, you know, facade fool you, because they're really, a lot of them are just grave robbers, just as much as anybody else, you know, in the past. So it's really frustrating to me. When I initially saw this story, I thought, oh, seriously, another kind of illegal dealing. So, but that's sort of played down in the story. They obviously mention it and whatever, but it's just not something that I think they emphasize enough, and, you know, probably for good reason, but I still think it's a notable thing. So they ended up, you know, getting it through paying smugglers who intercepted the artifacts. It was just really crazy. So from the start, it was a little bit shady. And another thing that was quite interesting I found was that it was broken up into pieces, but when they acquired it, it was sort of already put back together.
Yes.
So I thought that was interesting too, because, you know, somebody had to have been able to at least read that, unless the pieces were just so, you know, it was so apparent that you could just put it together. But according to, you know, the story, there were other artifacts. So I don't really know. I can't say for certain, but I do think that it's quite interesting that somebody had gone to the trouble of sort of putting it all together already. So, but they clearly couldn't have known what they had, because they only sold it for $800.
And
which is worth far more than that.
That's where I was going with this. The smugglers obviously didn't know what they had. They just thought it was cool, right? They thought it was an ancient artifact. They had no idea that it probably came from, 20 centuries BC, you know, some crazy 19th or 20th century BC tablet. They didn't know. They probably didn't know that it was Gilgamesh. They had no idea. And we're going to talk about the story of Gilgamesh in a second, the epic, but that this actually had a couple of extra lines in it that the other tablets that were telling the story of Gilgamesh didn't have. It's a very important artifact, and they sold it for $800.
Exactly.
It is about as priceless as anything there is. You know, I don't know if it's Mona Lisa status, but it's right there. $800. And if this is going on, Heather, it's going on everywhere. These guys are
everywhere.
Yeah, they're trading artifacts, or breaking into different museums all over Iraq. They're stealing tablets, the Sumerian culture, whatever, getting it back onto the black market and just selling it. And they have no idea what it is that they have in their possession. And that's exactly what happened with the Tablet 5, isn't it?
It is exactly what happened. They don't know what they have. It's something that has gone on since the beginning of archaeology. Initially, archaeology was a hobby. It was a a hobby of antiquarianism that was practiced by the elites who had the money to go off on extravagant adventures and hire natives to do a lot of labor. And, you know, this was sort of an elitist hobby. And once it became really apparent that, wait a second, you're robbing other cultures so that you can bring these items back as trophies, essentially, and, you know, just take all the credit or house them in your estate or maybe, you know, donate them to a museum after you're gone or however that is, there became, you know, a little bad taste in people's mouth for that. So the answer was, well, what we'll do is we'll legitimize this antiquarianism and turn it into a science, and we'll call it archaeology. And we'll do. And so this archaeology itself is actually not a very old practice, but it's it was invented essentially to, you know, legitimize the grave robbing hobbies of the elites.
Well, with what the British were doing, well, not just the British, but the British and the French, in the 1800s and early 1900s, is it any different that, you know, than what is going on today?
No, it's branded differently. That's all.
That's
rebranded.
Right. And I think that the British and the French were doing it in this spirit of, well, theft, but the spirit of we're protecting this because the Egyptians can't take care of it. You know, it's just going to get ruined and their museums can't deal with the whatever excuses they were using back then, humidity, dust, debris, and so forth. And so they would take it, and now it's all sitting in the British Museum and it's sitting at the Louvre, and it's not in Cairo now, but it was still, you know, I don't know, people get outraged with this word, but it was still theft, right?
It was. There's just really no way around it. I mean, your intentions could be well, but if you're taking something that doesn't belong to you, it's still theft. I mean, if I think that you have a really cool, like, you know, TV, it's like, it's kick ass. It has like a beautiful display and it's just awesome. Great sound, but you really treat it poorly. You don't dust it. And I think, you know what? He really shouldn't have that. I'm going to walk into Jimmy's house and take that television from him because I think in my house, it would look much better. It would be better. And I would take much better care of it and appreciate it more. And more people would get to view it. So therefore, it's okay to just walk in and take it, right? I mean, it's not. It's ridiculous. It's so, but see, you can't have such a plain analogy like that and reason with people in these positions because what they'll do is they'll, you know, academize it. They'll say, let's go back and forth with some, you know, lofty discussions and some discourse and just basically talk so much that they believe their own talk. And so they feel justified in doing these things. But when you really cut it down in just a plain way, it's the same as just walking into somebody's place and taking something.
This is Fade to Black. More with Heather Lynn, the Renegade Archaeologist. When we come back, right after this short break, stay with us.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church.
You're listening to Fade to Black.
Always on the edge of the hottest alternative talk. Jimmy Church with Fade to Black. KGRARadio.com.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón. Y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Did you ever turn to your radio for your favorite talk show to find that it's been preempted for this?
In the air to deep right center. Back goes Lewis to the wall.
Or this?
And I'm ashamed of you, Hillary, for voting for it.
Do you have a favorite talk radio program that's not available in your city? Just go to TalkStreamLive.com for links to the best streaming talk radio shows. At TalkStream Live, you will find live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All your favorites are here. With such a large selection, you will also discover some new favorites. On the go and still want to listen? With the mobile smartphone, simply type TalkStream Live on your internet browser. Now you can take internet radio with you. You will also find hundreds of music, news, and sports streams. Best of all, the TalkStream Live directory is free and there's never a login required. Remember TalkStreamLive.com, the fastest route between you and your favorite talk radio show.
You are listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Oi, oi, I'm Rhys Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Tonight, Dr. Heather Lynn is with us, the Renegade Archaeologist. Tomorrow night, Joshua P. Warren and Jay Widener are right here. And then Wednesday, Alec Teplish and his new book, The Epic of the Anunnaki. Heather, I know you're probably watching Twitter, and it is spun a little bit out of control. But I want to go straight to Walter here, who's one of your biggest fans. And he wants to know, what sinister relics? and it's funny, he posted the picture of the history and the lore of the sinister relics, and he wants to know what sinister relics.
Well, it's not necessarily Near Eastern in origin completely, but there are some Near Eastern aspects to that. But in my book that I'm currently working on, it's called Evil Archaeology. That's where I discuss sinister relics, some of which are the Pazuzu and different Sumerian gods, Akkadian gods, and Babylonian gods. Those are typically where we as the Christian Western civilization get our notions of what demons were. So I talk a little bit about, like I mentioned, Pazuzu. That was the demon that was cited in the movie The Exorcist.
Mm-hmm.
But Pazuzu is actually a Sumerian god, so, or a demon. So yeah, I just basically go into the demon's djinn possession and the artifacts that are said to be haunted, things like that. So, are they really haunted? I can't say, but some people sure believe they are. On my website, if you go to the area under books where it has the evil archaeology, you can see a video of an Aztec goddess being analyzed, basically. It shows it's a really gruesome thing. It's very beautiful, but when you take a really good look at its details, you can see that it's dressed in human hearts and snakes, and it was deemed so frightening that the archaeologists who found it actually reburied it.
Are you talking about the Coatlicue?
Yes.
Yeah. Tell me, I did watch the video, and for everybody, you can just go to drheatherlynn.com and go check it out. But why was it so frightening that didn't they rebury it?
They did rebury it, absolutely. Yeah, they took one look at it and thought, no, we're not doing this. So maybe here's the thing. It's frightening, but it's when you look at it, it looks like a beautiful piece of art. You have to really analyze it and look at it to see some of these details. It's definitely what it is. It's made of snakes, and so it's a little creepy, but it's still interesting to me that they would go to the trouble of reburying it, because it's not really graphic or gratuitous in any way. There's no blood. There's no, you know, it's, so I find it quite interesting. I wonder if maybe, you know, there was something to it. Maybe they felt, maybe once they had it in their possession, they had something, they had some kind of feeling, you know, that feeling that creeps you out, like eyes are watching you or something in the night. We don't know. Sometimes, this is something I address in the book, sometimes belongings or houses, I'm not going to say they're haunted per se, but they can carry energies, negative energies. So if this thing, if this artifact possibly had some kind of negative energy, negative vibe to it, if you will, then maybe in addition to its frightful appearance, they picked up on that and just thought, no, this would be bad luck for us. We're not doing this. So I don't know.
Well,
I don't know.
Could it have been, you know, I kind of put myself in the mindset of the Aztecs back then. Do you think they carved it to scare the crap out of the people? You know, maybe it was there to instill fear in the population.
I mean, probably a little of that, I would say. I would say that a lot of times what you get in these, you know, earlier civilizations, and a lot of the time with the Near Eastern civilizations, are demons that are very frightening, and they're meant to not only, you know, scare the people, but also scare other demons. So it may have been, you know, almost a good luck charm, because that's sort of the weird duality of these things in the ancient's mind, is right. That, you know, these demons, if you had one demon and there's another demon, your demon better be scarier than the other demon so it can scare that demon away. And so it could be looked at as a good thing to have that representation, you know, in like a statue or some kind of votive, because if you have that demon, well, it's better than having the other demon. So, you know, that's the only demon that's strong enough to, you know, stand up to this demon, and so on and so forth. So it's really not as easy as saying, well, it scared the people, or it scared, it could have been a little of all that. So,
well, there was also the aspect of, you know, beheadings and sacrifices, and the other thing that was, you know, the other stuff that was going on in society too, as well. I mean, what does that tell us about the Aztecs?
Well, I think too, that is just it reinforces that was the culture. It's sort of a, I don't want to say culture of death, but I mean, it was certainly a culture of decapitation. So it's just right. One of those things where, you know, it reflected the culture that it came from. So absolutely, it probably was used to scare a whole host of people, and it worked on the archaeologists that found it many years later. So I find that to be quite interesting.
With these evil relics and stuff that is out there, is there a subculture of well-to-do people that are out pursuing these icons, and they're trying to get them before somebody else does? Is there a subculture of that?
Without a doubt, yes. And I'm not going to say that, like, some of the Aztec ones and different things, I think that's I don't know for sure. I would say probably, because to each his own, everybody has their interests. But I know without a doubt that that's happening with different Sumerian artifacts. I know that they're in, you know, some of these more well-to-do families. There are sort of internal divide. There's a schism. These families are vying for power. And at some point, you reach a point where you have so much money and so much power, you start to focus your energies on different things that are sometimes more symbolic in nature. But this is what I found. This is what I found once I started traveling through that rabbit hole that the Sumerian controversy opened up. And Land of the Watchers just took me right through. And what I found is that's exactly why these people are looting. That's why there's all this theft. They're looking for something. You know, some people said, is it Stargate? Is it this? Is it that? You know what? This is what I believe that it is. What they're looking for is proof that they are the rightful rulers of the entire world. They want that proof. They want to connect their bloodline to that of the Sumerian kings. And it's a race to the finish over which elite family is going to be able to prove that without a doubt somehow. Not necessarily to us, the people, but to the other families, sort of like a, see, it's us, get off our back, we won.
I'm picturing some ceremony at some castle in, I don't want to say, you know, some crazy bloodletting, sacrificial, dark ceremony around this new artifact that they've just spirited out of Syria. You know, is that what is going on?
I believe so, and I believe that what I wrote about the Sumerian mountain oil, I believe that has a lot to do with it too. I think that the oil aspect of this is also quite strong, in addition to the gold, but I think the oil component is very important when you speak in terms of symbolism and ritual. So, you know, since the dawn of time, people have been using oil for rituals. But the word petroleum literally means rock oil, you know. And so when you look at that, it's wow, how old is this? This is something that's quite interesting. It's, you know, not necessarily a new invention, although our refining techniques are new. There are natural petroleum seeps, you know, springing from the ground, and so you could find oil, you know, coming from the ground in Mesopotamia easily. There are accounts of it being harvested, if you will, collected, what have you, and used in ceremony. The Sumerian records mention various oils, the cedar oils, vegetable oils, and different things. But they also mention this mountain oil, and it's an oil that came from the rocks. It would seep through the rocks. It sounds a lot to me like petroleum, like rock oil. So, you know, I've looked into that a lot and found that there are definitely strange yet almost familiar rituals that were taken on to honor Inanna. So that who was actually the daughter of Nana and Nigal, who is associated with Venus.
Right.
Yeah, so those rituals to honor Inanna were specifically done with this special mountain oil. And so it's a little.
How did they use the oil in the ritual?
The tablets are conveniently, it seems, broken on some of those very specific parts. The only parts that it talks about are them being, you know, involved in sort of a. How would you say, like, I don't want to say a full-out orgy, but a little bit of a sexual bent to it, that kind of temple prostitution factor. There's that, there's the bloodletting, and then there's the mixing the blood and the oil, and using oil to sort of anoint the head. And it had to be this particular mountain oil. So, you know, there's a lot of really odd things. In addition to that one, there's the burning of the oil that was supposed to kind of renew the earth and please the gods and that sort of thing. So it's to me, I think there's more to it. I think that this oil, this quest for oil, is not only important because it's a resource, we use it for fuel, et cetera, but I think there are some symbolic aspects to that as well. I think that is, you know, well, in fact, I've spoken with some people on the inside who speak about the quest for burning oil, or at least, you know, using as much oil as possible. So maybe like an anti-environmentalism kind of thing, that those are the people that are wanting to burn oil, and they look at it in a sacrificial sense, that they're somehow going to reap the benefits of, you know, whatever it may be, of pleasing the gods or so on, to if they burn this oil. So they look at it like, well, you must burn all this oil. It's good to burn oil. And then you have this other faction of sort of like the, you know, the Gaia worship, the, you know, environmentalists who say, you know, no, we don't want to burn the oil. It's sacred. We want to use the oil. We have to hold on to the oil. And so, and of course, this isn't everybody. These are people who I believe just get so wrapped up into the power and whatever that they just start to, I guess, become eccentric. You know, when you're poor, you're crazy. But when you're rich, you're simply eccentric. I mean, that's what that is. It's you can have these thoughts, you can have these beliefs, and you can, you know, do all these different things if you're wealthy, and it's just simply you're being eccentric or what have you. So I think that's really what it is. I think that there are ritualistic aspects to it for sure. You know, it's not only through Mesopotamia. The Seneca people used petroleum from oil seeps in their rituals. And interestingly, the rituals were similar, not necessarily with the sexual component or the bloodletting, but aside from that, with just the regular, you know, christening, their rituals were very similar to those of the Sumerians. So it seems almost like, and this is something that I have been researching further, that there is I'm not going to go so far as to say universal, but let's just say very widespread practice of this particular, you know, petroleum christening. And so I think that there's a little more to that than what most people want to discuss or look into even. But the tribe became known by the pioneers for their oil because they would trade it. And that oil would later become known as snake oil. That's the same oil that William Rockefeller Sr., father of John D. Rockefeller, made a living by selling as a con man.
Right.
His dad was literally a snake oil salesman, but he had it bottled, and he called it rock oil. He claimed that it had very special life extension capabilities, and so he would, you know, go and sell it from place to place and do that. But this idea of it being the elixir of life, that's something that also is a common thread that binds these ancient petroleum ritual mythologies, is that this petroleum is somehow the elixir of life.
It's kind of funny, isn't it, how we are burning it up all day long, and we can actually turn it around and have it be valuable again in the future when it is completely rare. And then it turns mm-hmm. back into the elixir of life and is something that could be worshipped again and used as its power. It's kind of funny. And maybe that's why the elite is burning it up. It's, you know, it's kind of a weird concept, but it could turn back into something precious again and something that is used as in a ceremony as the elixir of life.
That's exactly what I found to be some of the prevailing thoughts of you know, but this is another thing that's interesting. I've had people who have, you know, spoken with me about this, about their families, or they've given me tips or what have you. And I've been surprised at the people that have contacted me. A lot of them were people from the industries that I'm exposing. And so I initially am thinking, well, this has to be disinformation or, you know, what is it? But then later I started to discover that, no, I think it's really the case. But what I think it is the strong, like, internal war that's going on between all these people, that they're willing to, you know, try to do whatever they can to sabotage the other, or at least find out what the other's doing. And, you know, their minds aren't completely on us. We're just collateral damage. They have a mission and they're fighting each other. So, and they're using countries as a proxy war to do that.
Sure. I'm picturing some crazy ritualistic ceremony at, you know, some Bilderberg function. And them
the eyes wide shut thing.
Yeah. And anointing themselves with petroleum, you know, with crude oil right on the forehead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, man.
I think there's more truth to that than not.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, it's actually disturbing.
Yeah, it is quite disturbing.
You had mentioned earlier stargates. Is there any evidence of one being discovered and being covered up and that type of ancient technology being suppressed?
There are accounts, but there's really, unfortunately, no evidence that I would call evidence. I would like to say, sure, but no, I've heard some stories. I've spoken with members of the military who have told me that they've seen things like that. I've spoken with a lot of people that I have no reason to believe are not telling me the truth. I believe they believe what they're saying. But without having laid eyes on it myself, I really can't say that there's proof of that. But I'm still looking because I don't rule anything out. Not anymore. I've always been pretty open-minded, but whew, now after all this, after all that I've gone through, especially this past year, my mind is just open, wider than it ever has been. So I'm not putting anything out of the equation at this point.
Give me one of the rumors that they mentioned.
I spoke with a gentleman who claimed to have been part of an organization that was a small team of anthropologists that were put together by the government and sent in to the Middle East, various parts, Afghanistan and a few other places, some small places, to sort of collect intel on the people and their feelings and, you know, just their general ethnography so that they could bring that back and, I don't know, I guess see what they could use to, you know, I really don't know what they were going to do with the information, and he didn't seem to offer anything more substantial. He just said they were going there to collect the data about the people. He said that particularly in Afghanistan, there were things that the people in the village that he had to sort of interview were insisting were buried underneath different houses, structures, different things, and that was what they were really looking for. And that, you know, he basically said that one older man took him to a spot that was underneath his house, like not underneath his house, but sort of just like, he said it, he described it as being like a cellar, like an old time storm cellar or something like that, but they had stone instead of wood. And he kind of moved the stone out of the way and said, it's down there. And of course the gentleman did not, you know, go into the hole or anything, but he's claimed that this man was swearing up and down that if somebody were to come, like go down that hole, they would appear on the other side of the world. And the guy from the military is saying, you know, I thought he was crazy. He's just telling me this stuff like, you know, he dug a hole so deep and went to China or something. But then the woman comes out and starts saying, no, like you can't show them this. You can't show them this. And, you know, we're going to get bombed and you hide that. I thought you didn't, you know, tell, you weren't supposed to tell anybody this and all this. And so, you know, at that point, that was enough of a weird story that the gentleman had to, you know, tell me that he thinks that maybe there was something like some teleportation aspect of this hole to it. Now, I don't know how. There's really no way to prove that. You'd have to go back to that little place and find that particular man and, you know, try to break through the cultural and language barrier, too. And I have no reason to think that this, you know, military personnel, you know, made the story up. But on the other hand, it's just still a story. So these are the types of things that I run into a lot, are just, you know, really interesting or compelling stories, but nothing really super solid. I'm still looking for something really, like, give me coordinates, give me pictures. You know, a lot of times pictures are, you know, Photoshopped to death. So even pictures nowadays, you just can't trust. So.
Well, yeah, but that spot is probably called Camp Charlie now, and we occupy it. Yeah, that's interesting. And there was also, it lit up the internet a couple of years ago, the stories about the Vimana that was found in Afghanistan. And that story, whether true or not, seemed to die a quick death. There was so much rumor going around about it. There were videos out, there were stories out, and then nothing. Did you look into that?
A little bit, but it disappeared as quickly as it came. And you know, but I gotta say, something that's interesting to do, and this is one thing that I did to sort of cross-reference or check out this one guy's story about the possible Stargate or teleportation aspect of, you know, this hole in Afghanistan. I went on WikiLeaks, and I just did a general search for archaeology, anthropology, and when you do that, I would urge everybody out there, just go on there, you know, pour a drink, kick back, take a few hours, and just get ready, because I don't think a lot of people realize that, you know, archaeology is of such interest to governments, and so much so that they would cover anything up. So go on WikiLeaks, look for archaeology, and you'll find some things. So what I found specifically, I did find evidence to corroborate the gentleman's story about there being a team of anthropologists sent to the region to do that very thing. I've downloaded the documents and read through it and seen that they spent a lot of money and a lot of time trying to find anthropologists and archaeologists to have sort of a little secret team to go over there and collect data. But it wasn't the data collecting that you'd expect. Like, it wasn't about artifacts or history or any of that. It was literally for a PSYOP, and that was the terminology they used in the document. It was an anthropological PSYOP. And so, and this is, you can find this right on WikiLeaks. I can't remember the name of the document, but I will dig that document up off of my hard drive, and I will put that on my website for a free download so people can go and find that, because it's quite eye-opening. You know, it's another example of how important history and archaeology really is. It's not just fascinating little thing to learn about. It has power, so much so that our governments and other governments are spending money in order to use it to their advantage.
Right. To use a PSYOP campaign against the Taliban, against the Afghan people, to find out something that would that they could use as a weapon, not something tangible, but something psychological, something so deep that they could use it as a weapon back at them?
Absolutely. And that's exactly what they're doing. They wanted to sort of go in and they wanted to use ethnography and study these people and then turn it into a complete PSYOP. So, yeah, that's a little telling right there.
It is. Do you have any idea what it was that they found out?
No, what I did find out through this document, though, was that the operation was abruptly stopped with no explanation. It ended as quickly as it started. It was just sort of a weird kind of thing. So I think it was last year. I remember something coming out on the news about how, and this is another one of those examples of something coming out and then just disappearing right away. But they were sending in British, and I want to say American as well, but maybe not. It might have just been British. But they were sending teams of archaeologists in, like through the military, to a lot of these Middle Eastern sites in order to secure them. But yeah, good job, right? And how are you going to do that with just like small teams? It's just ludicrous. I think it's either some kind of a money laundering, you know, scheme, some kind of public relations, you know, front. It's all out propaganda, but whatever it is, it's definitely not the modern day monuments men. They're not sending people out to really do anything.
What do you think it was? We talked about this the last time on your show, but ultimately there was something that drove the elite to err. What was it ultimately, and did they come away with something?
Well, I think it really does come back down to the, wanting to sort of prove their lineage in a way to these Sumerian kings. Because if they presumably could do this in their mind, if they could do this, then they can prove like the right of rule, the divine right of kings. They can say, you know, these were the first kings that were positioned here, sent here from above, and we are of their bloodline, therefore we are the rightful rulers of the entire world. And that's exactly what I believe sent them to Ur to begin with, is the search for that documentation. I mean, this royal bloodline goes a little further back, but the documentation of it is really something that can be found through the Sumerians because they were excellent record keepers. But one thing that I know without a doubt that they're looking for, one artifact in particular, you could call it the Holy Grail, if you will, of Holy Grails. It's the Tablet of Destinies. And the Tablet of Destinies was sort of depicted as a clay tablet that had the general cuneiform writing and had cylinder seals on it. But what it was supposedly a legal document that was permanent. It was just, this was it. It was given by the gods and given to Enlil to show his supreme authority over not only the ruler of the world, but the ruler of the universe. I mean, we're talking like huge, huge power trip here. And so supposedly whoever has these tablets would then rule the universe. And so there's a lot of mythology. There's stories about how, you know, that these tablets, you know, exchange hands and, you know, it just goes on and on. But the whole thing is those tablets were lost. They're gone, but there's pieces of them supposedly, you know, in various parts of Mesopotamia. And these elite families are looking for the Tablet of Destinies. And it is my understanding that some of them have some pieces, others have other pieces. And at this point, it's a race to find who has all these pieces, which is causing a lot of issues. So what it will do for them in their minds is give them this universal authority, this sort of permanent legal document that will say we have, you know, the divine right of rule based on our bloodline, and now, and we can prove it through this legal document, and now we just, you know, we rule. It's as simple as that. They're looking for power.
Is there any suggestion of hidden knowledge on the Tablet of Destiny as well?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. So whoever has the Tablet of Destinies would be able to, in addition to having that supreme authority over the whole world, they have all the knowledge of not just the past and present, but also the future. So it really gives them this sort of God-type presence. It's the ultimate transhumanism. It's the ultimate apotheosis. It's all that kind of, you know, bizarre life extension, you know, fetishism that's going on with these elites. They're looking for something to give them that universal power, but also all of the, you know, attributes that you would generally connect to a God figure. So all knowing, basically having all that wisdom, both past, present, and future, being able to rule over everybody, to subjugate everybody on the earth, and to have the ultimate power and strength and stamina, and then, of course, everlasting life, to never die. So with these people, if you really want to look at it, what they're really looking to do, what their main goal is to become God. What they want is to become God, and they want to be our God. So at this point, it is a race against time, and, you know, we're collateral damage. There are so many things going on behind the scenes, but at the very top, there are individuals who are essentially just wanting to become God at the expense of the rest of the world.
When a dog learns a new trick, he's taught. when knowledge, you know, teachers teach, they pass on knowledge to future generations. They teach. They were taught from somebody else. They were shown something. That's the way the world works. And you can go back millennia. Everything is just taught from one generation to the next. And if we go back to zero, you know, we don't figure things out. Everything was taught to us. The wheel was taught to us from somebody somewhere. Fire, math, everything is taught. So, and if we keep backing up and we talk about the tablets of destiny and we go back to the Sumerian tablets and we go back to the Anunnaki and we go back, everything is taught from a previous generation. Somebody was taught. It had to have started somewhere. Somebody taught us, you know, where does that knowledge start? Where does it come from?
You know, that's the $1 million question, isn't it? If we had that, where does it come from? Because there's teaching, like you said, you can train a dog to do a trick and whatnot, but you know, there's other animals that are sentient beings, and you really just can't train them. They just don't get it. They're not as intelligent. So in addition to that whole, like, well, where did it begin? You really got to think about, well, where did it begin within us? What is this origin of consciousness? How is it that we were able to, you know, even learn these things or pass these things on? Something happened. There was something that happened that made, you know, our ancestors not only, well, something to make them teachable, basically. So, you know, there's learned behavior. There's like monkey see, monkey do. I mean, primates of all sorts can just mimic things. But there's a difference between just mimicking something and then creating, you know, a culture. Using words, using symbols, that sort of abstraction that comes with higher level thinking, and that's that comes with language. So these things, something happened not only on Earth, but to humans, to our kind. Something happened within us on maybe a biological level, some kind of conscious level that allowed us to even be taught these things. So where does that begin? That's like I said, the $1 million question. That's something I sort of, you know, tackled a little bit in a book called Anthrotheology, talking about the origin of consciousness being something that, you know, might be also very physical with something that happens in the brain. So, you know, there's no telling where this began. Nobody has any good evidence to suggest that, especially if you want to look at it in a biological sense, because you can have skulls all day and you can get a lot of information from what the brain looked like when you examine a skull, but still the brain, the soft tissue, it goes away. So we really don't know.
Well, that's exactly where I'm going at. It's not only in a mechanical sense, rocks, a wheel, you know, all of that. Mm-hmm. But there's the biological side, the anthropology behind it, where we just are. Right. We don't know. We just appeared 150,000 years ago. Boom, bam. Here we are. We are the only ones on planet Earth like us. Nothing else evolved. You know, I get this argument all the time. No. Other things have evolved. No, they have not. Monkeys and gorillas have not evolved. They're not building condos in trees now. You know, they have not evolved one little bit. Everything that they has evolved with them comes from us teaching them sign language. They haven't invented. You know what I'm saying? So,
mm-hmm. All right.
That magical thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that magical thing that anthropologists and archaeologists are, no, it just is. Well, no, it isn't just is.
No,
the odds of that are astronomical. That thing that changed in our DNA, Heather, that thing that made us think, laugh, have humor, intelligence, and everything else, and those capabilities is not something that just happened. And that's the part where you, I don't know if we get into divine intervention. I don't know. I don't know if it's ET. I don't know. But somebody was there, and this is my point. Somebody was there to teach us. Somebody did a drive-by and taught us all of those things to get us on our way. And maybe they came back and suggested a few hints along the way too as well. But it certainly wasn't magic.
There's something that happened, definitely. I mean, I do believe that in the basic idea of evolution, in terms of adaptation, I think that some of these ideas aren't mutually exclusive. You can have, you know, natural selection. You can have all these things and also still have the questions that we're asking tonight. It's almost like people want to say, well, you know, religion or spirituality, and this isn't true, or it's not, you know, it doesn't work with science. And I just don't agree. I don't think that you necessarily have to say it's one over the other. I think that, you know, we live in a universe large enough to be able to contain, you know, multiple ideas at the same time. So I think that maybe evolution or natural selection are things that were utilized as tools, perhaps. But this goes back to that whole idea of, you know, what makes modern humans different. I mean, we diverge, definitely, but something else happened. And, you know, I'll have to take it back to Göbekli Tepe. I really do.
Let's do it.
You did. I have to go there because the evidence found there clearly indicates that more than just simple existing was taking place. I mean, this is something I get asked a lot is, well, what's up with the Sumerians? Why is that important? I mean, they're not, you know, the oldest human species. They're not the oldest. Why are they so important? And this is something to really think about because settlements like Göbekli Tepe, it's an example of civilization, like the beginnings of civilization. But there was still something missing. There was something missing out of there. Now, did they have spirituality? Probably. I would say they probably did. Some people argue, of course, that the Göbekli Tepe is a spiritual site, that it was a temple. There's a lot of evidence to suggest that it was not, that it was actually just a multi-purpose domestic settlement. So, I mean, still, it's still up in air as to what it really was, but no matter what, you have to look at it and say, this is something. It's more than simply being. But the question to ask is, does it constitute civilization? You know, that's the difference. I mean, you can be civilized in the sense that, you know, you have, you're courteous to each other, you have the golden rule, you have all these different, you know, ethics, but what is civilization? And so civilization is usually described as a human society where a high level of culture, science, industry, and government has been found. So, I mean, those are the important factors that make a civilization and not just a gathering of people or, you know, a settlement. So there so far hasn't been enough evidence to suggest that there was civilization in that textbook sense at Göbekli Tepe. So then you have these big gaps. And so that's where the Sumerians come in because, you know, it's something different happened there. The something would do more than just simply plant the seeds of human civilization. It would go on to develop complex systems and hierarchies like the world had never seen before. Things that we still use today, like economics.
Math.
Like
paper, yes. Like
math. There you go. Everything.
Accounting. I mean, accounting.
Yes.
Yeah, that's an amazing part of it. You know, yeah, we can throw in the wheel. Okay, sure.
All right, yeah.
You know, but it's the other aspects that make it complex. That is mind-blowing. Now, and which brings me to, it doesn't just appear. Accounting, taxation, governments, farming, agriculture, all of this doesn't just appear. They were taught. It came from somewhere. I don't have any problems with admitting that, but historians would just stop right there. No, you're not giving them enough credit. You know, they were just creative. You're not right. Giving them credit. No, I call BS. They were taught. What's wrong with that? It could be some ancient culture from eons ago, but nonetheless, it was taught to them. That's the aspect of it that I just can't get why academia just will not expand. You know, Tammy just said, she just tweeted out, Jimmy, it's because your mind is closed. No, it's because my mind is open. I want to look at this with another, you know, with another set of eyes. I just feel that if I'm teaching my dog something, Heather, and that dog learns something, and we can teach sign language or words to chimpanzees, I get that. Well, and we teach our children in school. Well, that's what has been going on all the way back to the mystery schools and beyond and Sumerian culture. For them to learn how to write and to figure things out like that, it's because somebody said, this is how you do it. Check this out. Okay, this is how you do it. And I don't have a problem with that. If you went back to school right now, would you have a problem with, like, every aspect of history?
As in?
If you went back to school right now, knowing what you know today, would you just go back and fight Professor every step of the way?
Oh, you know, let me tell you, yeah, that would definitely be the case. But you know where I would really lose my mind? I would lose my mind if I had to go back to elementary school. I'd be bonkers. The things they are teaching our children in elementary school is just mind blown. This is why people don't like history. I mean, a lot of people, luckily there's enough people that are waking up to it and see the importance of it and find, you know, the fascinating aspects of it. But if you took a general poll of the general population and you asked about history, they would say, oh, you know, it's, you sit around and you got to memorize dates and, you know, figures and all that. But no, that's what they want you to believe. This is a convenient thing, because let me tell you something about history. History is a dynamic study. It is alive. It is not dead. It is not decided. There's nothing about it that is closed. Even when you think you have evidence, there can be arguments made to the contrary. You can find more evidence. It is constantly changing. Our history is not set. And this is the big difference right here. This is what they don't want you to know. When they teach, when they indoctrinate children with this idea that history happened, here's what it is, move along, don't ask any questions, just memorize these facts. What it does, not only is it, you know, detrimental because you're sometimes memorizing the wrong facts, it's also boring because it's based on rote memorization, but what it does is it kills, it absolutely kills your ability to have critical thinking, research skills, and arguing. So, because in history, as the study, you know, I've gotten asked this before, because when I did my master's, I went for history specifically, and I got asked this. Like, it's one thing when you go for archaeology, people seem to know, oh, that's what you're doing. You're digging, you're, you know, researching, but what do you do in history? Well, you just memorize things. I have been asked the craziest things at dinner parties, like, so you must know a lot of, like, I'm a walking dictionary or encyclopedia of just random dates and facts and figures. And I'm like, no, that is not what history is about. History is about being able to critically analyze sources. That's the number one thing. It's about analyzing sources and looking for the credibility in that. Now, if you really look at how history is practiced this way, you will soon come to realize why it's not taught that way in, you know, government-run elementary and, you know, secondary schools, because you don't want a population of people who can stand and say, wait a second, that, you know, if you looked at it through this particular lens, you know, this wouldn't actually be how history is interpreted and yada, yada, yada. There'd basically be a bunch of people who could argue a side of something and not accept the status quo. And so they'd be the most dangerous people in the world. So it's very important now for controlling the population to teach our children that history is nothing but an exercise in memorizing dates, figures, and facts, and moving on and accepting the authority that's before them.
That's a really interesting paradigm shift if it could be pulled off, in that Hollywood is going to show you these renegade archaeologists, right? And they're there to learn about our past, and they want to learn. And that's Hollywood. you know, the Indiana Jones, Jurassic Park, let's change, you know, let's learn about the past and let's change it. Well, but that isn't the case. Instead, the answer is no. You know, you find something that may change the past, and the answer is no. And look at Göbekli Tepe, for bringing it up a second time. Göbekli Tepe wasn't supposed to exist. It's certainly not 5 or 7,000 years before Giza. It wasn't supposed to exist. And now it's here, and they're still in denial about its significance. It's not headline news on CNN, and it should be. This is a true history-changing site. And it's the word no is coming up. Zahi Hiwass did the famous thing with Graham Hancock. Did you see that video that popped up like 6 months ago?
Yes.
and Graham Hancock asked Zahi, well, what about Göbekli Tepe? I know nothing about Göbekli Tepe. I know nothing. It's crazy, isn't it? It's a dream. I agree with you. History is alive, and we should be learning from it and rewriting and learning. But no, you know, there isn't a college on this globe that is willing to just take a step back and treat it like it's alive and rewrite and learn from our past.
Yeah, it's a real change, especially, you know, if you take the you know, like freshman courses in like, you know, Western Civ or something, you do go through still like almost high school and, you know, learn some basic things and test on facts. But once you move up and then once you hit graduate school, it's like a whole different animal, because it no longer is about necessarily what happened, but how you interpret how that happens. And I started to learn what I learned through a graduate program was not necessarily what they wanted me to learn. What I learned was how even more corrupt the system is, you know, because it's definitely the act of history, the act of making history. In fact, that was a textbook I had. I had a textbook called Making History. I had a class called Making History. And they meant that in the literal sense, that you as a historian have like this noble duty to literally make history. It's your interpretation of events that make them real. I mean, that's a big responsibility, I suppose, but is it necessarily, I mean, that's a dangerous thing, I think, when you kind of instill in a group of people, a closed group of people who use academia or degrees or paper, whatever kind of awards and accolades to make themselves feel special or better than other people, you put them together in a group and say, now you have this power of knowledge and, you know, it's your responsibility to be the caretakers. I mean, it sounds an awful lot like a mystery school, if you ask me, probably because it was based off of mystery schools. So it's happening now. It's alive and well. And, you know, if anybody, you know, just finds some of these books, just go in. They're very boring books, but when you do, it's like any other very boring thing. It's meant to be boring. It's meant to turn people away. So they're like, ugh, I don't want to trudge through this. Well, then they win. You know, you got to trudge through it sometimes. And when you do, it's like hidden in plain sight. And you'll see some things that'll just knock your socks off. Like, okay, yeah, it's your job as a historian to interpret the past in a way that is, you know, the public can handle or that promotes this or whatever. And it's just unbelievable. And it's not just academia, like, of course, this way. It's not just a traditional kind of, you know, way that is being taught. This is another thing that can be found through WikiLeaks. I stumbled across some information. I do this sometimes. I just, you know, sit back and pull up some WikiLeaks for, you know, entertainment. I don't know if anybody else does that or not.
We all do. We all do.
It's good times, right?
Yes, it is.
But in the global intelligence files part of WikiLeaks, there was a whole thing on this blew me away. This is evidence right here that it's all corrupt. And I include this with the names in Land of the Watchers. It is a back-and-forth email session between government leaders, I should say dignitaries rather than leaders, who wanted to promote a particular figure that was very liberal. They wanted to promote the idea of liberalism. And to do this, they contacted the family of the person who ended up being like a daughter-in-law or somebody who was not really, you know, too close to the person who had, you know, been deceased, and sort of, you know, said, hey, we want to do this, you know, book on, you know, your family, and you can have money, and, you know, would you give us the rights to his story? And she's like, sure, whatever, you know, and it's just sort of like a, you know, a nicey-nicey little thing, and then it turns a little more sinister when you start seeing how they say, well, what we're going to do is we're going to find, and these are like the inner company emails start to say, well, you know, we have, you know, this woman on board now. She's good. Now we have to work on revising this person's historic narrative. How will we do that? Well, you know, so-and-so's niece is a graduate student at Dartmouth, and she's looking for a master's, you know, thesis subject or whatever. So we could throw it to her, pay her to do the master's thesis, and then we can find a couple more like graduate students or academics somewhere in the mix to write kind of complementary versions of this history that we're manufacturing, and then they'll cite each other, and then through, you know, the workings of citations and that whole network, they're revising history, and they're doing it for cash, and they're doing it for political reasons, and it's all documented, and it is just mind blown again.
And then like, it is released as truth.
It's released as truth. So what we do is what we'll have, and this is going to go through some mainline publisher. So what we'll have is, if you look at some of the books that come out, some books that are, you know, on television promoted, on shows, on, you know, maybe if you listen to NPR or any of these, just real mainline kind of status quo books that are shopped around sort of like pseudo-intellectualism. And you'll find these books. What you don't know is that, you know, these weren't necessarily authors who were driven to or inspired to write the story, and then they put their manuscript out and got published, and the rest is history. No. They are sometimes people that have been hired and paid by, you know, it could be foreign governments, it could be local politician, it could be anywhere, anybody up the chain of command that has a vested interest. They can buy themselves history. They do it through buying academics. So you get a, you know, a grad student. Imagine some, you know, wet behind the ears student at an Ivy League school who just happens to be related to the right person that basically hands them their entire, you know, thesis work, everything. They feed it to them like the ultimate, you know, cheat. And
right.
they, in addition to that, they get paid.
So they get the material, they get the facts, they get any artifacts or any historical stuff that would get tied in with it. It's all laid out. All the work
is laid out.
All the work
is done. It is laid out. They get everything. So imagine, you know, these silver spoon kids running around having some parties and some great times, and they're, you know, getting cited like in papers and published in journals and whatnot because they have a team of people who work for these organizations, these research and, you know, whatever organizations, who write the papers for them, funnel it through them, and then, you know, they have to do it. They can't just find, you know, Susie at Dartmouth. They have to find, you know, Jimbo at Harvard and so on. And so they have to find a network. They have to create a network. They buy themselves a network because it doesn't cost that much money. It doesn't cost money to really, you know, buy somebody like that
in the long run, it's worth it.
The investment.
Exactly. In the long run, it's really cheap.
Yeah, absolutely. Because they're starting are like cultural revolutions. They're giving themselves let's just say this, you know, I'm going to bring it back to the Nazis because it always goes back to the Nazis with me. So like, just like Göbekli Tepe, we're going to say Nazis.
Okay.
So when you go and you look at what happened during that time, World War II, they really wanted to use things like, what ended up being eugenics, but it was anthropology, physical anthropology, really.
Yes.
I mean, it's all rebranded also, but they were using these methods. They were measuring noses and, like, you know, studying all these physical characteristics and to sort of promote racial hygiene. They couldn't have these policies. They couldn't do this if they didn't have science behind it. They had to have an air of legitimacy by showing that they had scientific evidence and all these experts and all these universities backing them. So, you know, that is a very typical strategy. You get all that to back you, and then, you know, you can move on. You're like sort of legitimized. So basically, if the common people say, wait a second, I don't think that you could say, nope, you're not an expert. You've not been to Harvard. You've not done this. You don't know what you're talking about. You know, leave it to the professionals kind of thing. Well, yeah, that's really the whole idea. So it's very important for them, for, you know, anybody in a position of power like this, to buy themselves credibility through, you know, academia or research or however they want to do it. And they still do it to this day.
Let's take a quick break. That's a good place to stop right there. And you want to take some phone calls?
Sure.
Let's do it. When we come back after the break, we'll be taking your calls. 323-825-5045 for Dr. Heather Lynn. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet.
Hi, everybody. This is Rob Halford, the Metal God, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
KGRA Radio. Intelligent talk.
Are you a paranormal investigator, ghost hunter, or UFO skywatcher? If so, FNGinnovations.com has the product you definitely need in your investigations kit or go bag. Introducing the Morpholite Wide Beam Tactical Flashlights that put the light where you need it most. Traditional flashlights shine a focused round beam with limited line of sight in the dark. Morpholite Tactical Flashlights change all that, utilizing a revolutionary wide beam design to enable you to see safety hazards such as hanging wires and steel, pipes, and holes in the floor you just can't see with a focused round beam. In the field, where safety is paramount, a 180-degree beam increases orientation and peripheral vision in the dark. Morpholite flashlights are ideal for investigations in abandoned facilities such as houses and hospitals, factories, caves, and tunnels. Avoid those low-hanging tree branches that poke your eyes in the woods. Visit FNGinnovations.com to see a full line of tactical lights and accessories. That's FNGinnovations.com.
Now you can find all your favorite talk radio shows live, all in one place at TalkStreamLive.com. Listen from anywhere, office, home, or in your car. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com and click on one of the many live talk show hosts you want to listen to. It's free and easy. No computer? Download the smartphone apps. Never miss your favorite talk show. Find them all at TalkStreamLive.com.
You want to know a secret? I love ponies. I really love ponies. I'm serious. I couldn't stay sane without ponies to brush.
Why fade to black? Because you never got that pony, damn it.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
All right, welcome back, Fade to Black. Phone lines are open, 323-825-5045. Tonight, Dr. Heather Lynn is with us, the Renegade Archaeologist. Tomorrow night, Joshua P. Warren and Jay Widener will be right here on Fade to Black. And Wednesday, Alex Teplish and his new book, The Epic of the Anunnaki. You know, Heather, I was just going through Twitter during the break. And let's see here. It was Steve that brought up an interesting point here. He says, this is the one reason why there has not been disclosure, you know, the ET question. It goes all the way back to the beginning of everything. And maybe that's what they're hiding. And it all kind of fits together. Have you ever had that thought enter the equation?
Yeah, I have. I think that the likely scenario, through what I've learned in my research and interviews and different things, for me, what I think would be the most likely scenario is it would be some kind of a close encounters type scenario where this has been going on for a while and there are, you know, definite deals that have been made. if that makes any sense. So that, you know, the disclosure aspect of it, yeah, good luck. I don't know that we're going to actually get that until, you know, if they figured it all out on their end. But I think that if there is such a thing to be had, I think it's definitely something like more of that close encounters of the third kind, where, you know, they have like a deal set up where they exchange people or who knows what. But I've heard that sentiment echoed a lot through people that I've interviewed who say that the government has known about this for a very long time, and it goes way back, and that this research into the past is much about that sort of pact or that agreement as it is about trying to pinpoint some sort of bloodline.
So, well, one of the things that you touch upon in Land of the Watchers is the ancient alien aspect to it, in that with not only Sumerians, but, you know, all cultures look to the skies, look to the heavens. Everything came down from the heavens. Everything came from the stars. All of our knowledge, all of the gods, everything, angels, what have you, came from out there. And what is wrong with that view? I don't understand why that
yeah.
view is just tinfoil hat craziness, when that's what right. everybody said the same thing. There isn't a culture out there that didn't have that very mindset.
Right. Yeah, you know, that's interesting too, with the exception of people who, you know, claim to be you know, maybe atheist or what have you. A large portion of the human population holds some sort of, you know, religious belief or spiritual belief, and a lot of those have mythology associated with them. So, you know, why is it acceptable to believe in, say, angels, but nothing maybe more biological, like, say, aliens? Like, I don't see much of a difference here. You hear that a lot of times. People, oh, there could be no aliens. There could be nothing like that, but yet, you know, they're definitely saints and angels and all host of, you know, whatever. I mean, so, yeah, I think that a lot of these things are maybe just different names for the same idea.
Is there an example where it's not the same? In other words, what I'm saying, is there an example where mainstream archaeology or anthropology or historians can say, see, but this is an example of it not being that. So can't we just go here? Is there an example of it not being that?
Well, you know, not really. I mean, there are enough examples. There's always exceptions to the rule. There are even, you know, tribes that are cultures that exist to this day that have no concept of God or any kind of you know, divine anything, no religion, no stories, no folklore. You know, that's another, you know, thing I write a little bit about in anthropology, is this idea that, you know, not all people throughout time have even believed in anything. Because most of the time what you'll hear is, well, people have always believed in this or that. You can tell by Paleolithic art, you know, everybody had, you know, shamans, and this is always back to spirituality. That just seems to be, when you really don't know, you can just say, well, it's ritual or spirituality. Well, that's not always the case, and there are plenty of examples where that's not the case. Or examples, you know, where maybe those spirits didn't come from out in the sky. Maybe they came from inside a mountain. You know, maybe they came from the underworld. You hear a lot about that in Native American belief, with the, you know, some of the underworld. This, I don't know if you're familiar with the work of Gary David, but he touches on some of that with the whole, you know, ant-like.
Yeah, the ant people
come out of. Yeah.
Sure.
So, I mean, I think those are some of the examples. It's not always the case, but it just seems like, I would say, you know, 80% of the case, they're coming from the sky. And I just think that's quite interesting.
Well, even the ant people had an antenna and helmets, which mm-hmm. I always thought was pretty crazy. Now, we are on the brink of, I think, one of the most exciting, I just hope it pans out, Nefertiti. and King Tut's tomb. Were you surprised that the Egyptian government is so open to investigating this and going in there with radar?
Yeah, I'm totally shocked. I am not surprised that this is, the theory. I'm not surprised that this is where they think, she could be. It makes all the sense in the world because they've always wondered, well, why was, Tut's tomb so small compared to, his status as a pharaoh? Like, he should have a much larger tomb. So the idea that this was the tomb was actually meant for Nefertiti, and then he died, at unexpected and young age, and they just kind of repurposed that tomb then. I mean, that really makes a lot of sense because, the ancients, for all their mystical aspects and their, romanticized ideals, they were very practical. They really did not waste things. They reused a lot of things. They were very practical people because in the end they were people. So it would make all the sense in the world that this was indeed Nefertiti's tomb. But what I'm shocked at is that they've even been allowed to look because, Egypt has not been very cooperative a lot of times. So, maybe because this was so mainline, like it's Nefertiti, maybe that's it. Or maybe they're trying to work on their, PR a little bit. I'm really not sure, but that is what caught me off guard.
Yeah, if it would have been Zahi, if he was involved in this, Zahi would have just jumped in. There is no Nefertiti. No.
Right.
She did not exist. There is nothing here. Go away. Go away. That would have been their attitude. For some reason, I mean, I was shocked. It didn't take any time at all for the new head of antiquities there to just go, yeah, there's something here. I did see a bunch of video of the wall there where it looks like Tut is burying Nefertiti. That is what is on the wall, and that is what is represented there. And
makes
that,
all the sense in the world, doesn't it?
It certainly does because, quite honestly, his tomb was dinky. it was just dinky. Now, just imagine everything else there. All the other KBs in the Valley of the King, Valley of the Kings, are huge. So many rooms. They haven't even got to the end of a couple of them yet. They just continue and continue and continue. Just imagine if we actually find. Isn't that exciting that we find it?
It is so exciting.
Oh, man, Nefertiti, of everybody, Nefertiti, and how big it can really be, because King Tut's is so small. It was the entrance to Nefertiti's tomb. You know what I mean? And that,
I think it quite literally was, really. I mean, I think they'll be able to find evidence to this. I think this really does go down, maybe it comes down to the PR aspect of it. I mean, a lot of people have been, tourism has gone down. Let's just say that. The tourism has gone down and, that's a big part of their economy. Perhaps the new person who's in there is a little more open to some of this, this good press, if you will. So, Zahi Hawass, he was quite the character. And I think that maybe was not the type of figure, the strong figure that they're looking for right now in this current state of, political turmoil that they're in right now.
Yeah, plus I'm getting tired of looking at King Tut's, gold sarcophagus. We need a new one. Let's go.
Yeah, really. We need something new. Come on.
We need something new. Let's go to the phones. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black. Who's calling? Say hi to Dr. Heather Lynn.
Good evening, Jimmy. I'm talking to you on my new higher-speed internet phone. Dr. Lynn, I have to ask you, I have to take all my undergraduate anthropology courses again after listening to you. I wondered if I could ask you, though, I don't know if it's your area of expertise. I have been reading a lot about Native American. I think he's a Sioux. Was it Mama Day, who has been writing about these these skins where Native Americans were recording history yearly, and some of the references perhaps to other off-world visitors that advised them or came to them. Do you know anything about that?
I don't, but I would love to know more about that. If you have any information on that, if you can send me any kind of...
I think the guy's name is Mama... Mama Day. He's oftentimes, he was on Ken Burns. He commented on a lot of Ken Burns' things about the West. I believe he's a professor. He's a Native American. I think he's a Sioux or a Cheyenne, and I think it's easy to find him. But Black Elk, when I was in college, I studied Black Elk Speaks, and a lot of the things he spoke about could have been just vision, or they could have been, you know, there could be anthropological artifacts here in America that could tell us a lot about our history.
Certainly. And so that would be on pelts then, that's amazing. Yeah, I've not really heard of that, but...
Okay, well, I'm sorry I jumped in there. I'll get off then, but if you learn more about it, come back on.
No, send...
I would love to. Thank you.
Yeah, send it to me. I'll forward it on to Heather.
Okay, I'll try to find it. Thanks, Jimmy.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I wanted to, Jeff just tweeted a great question, something that has been all over the net. I know you've been seeing this. He says, ask Dr. Lynn what your views are on the existence of archaeological structures on Mars.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one. I've spent a lot of time looking at these pictures because I'm very fascinated with this. I think that there are definitely things on Mars. I can't say I'm 100% sure because I'm not there and I'm not looking at it, but wow, if I had money to put down on it, I would say yes, there are definitely structures on Mars. Now, with that being said, there are a lot of websites, a lot of things going around on Facebook and memes and whatnot that show very doctored images of very specific artifacts on Mars. Some of those I'm not really believing, you know, but I think that the general structures, I've seen a lot of different things that just really point to there being something there. Now, whether I can't say that it's inhabited now. I know some people speculate that perhaps these are colonies that are there now or what have you, but I definitely think that there's a huge possibility that Mars was inhabited once, and that when we're able to go there and take a look, it's going to be like mind blown. So no, I definitely think that there are archaeological, you know, artifacts and structures on Mars. It's just a matter of how are we going to study them? How are we going to get there? But you know, you can tell by a lot of the images that the lines are very clean on some of these. Like they're not hills. They're not, you know, geological, you know, formations. Some could be. I mean, there's so many. Even on this planet, we don't know half the time. I've seen, like the Bosnian pyramids are a great example of people who say, well, you know, they're pyramids. Well, no, they're natural formations, and there's really no consensus on that either. So even on our own planet, we can't really decide when we see it for ourselves if something's man-made or not. So it is definitely speculation to say that these things, but I definitely think that they're there.
Hi, you're live on Fade to Black. Say hi to Dr. Heather Lynn. Who's calling?
This is Mark from Oregon. Hello, Dr. Heather Lynn.
Hi, Mark. How are you?
I'm great. There was something that you touched upon, the discovery of the fragment from Gilgamesh, scroll number 5, mm-hmm. and briefly mentioned that there were some new lines, and I just... Could you elucidate on what was in those lines, or have you seen a translation yet?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there's a lot of new things that kind of paint a broader picture of what the landscape was like, or even, you know, what animals. They speak of monkeys. One of the lines says, the chatter of monkeys, chorus of cicadas, and squawking of many kinds of birds formed a symphony that daily entertained the forest's guardian, Humbaba. So, you know, it kind of goes into more of a detailed picture. So it really enriches the story a little more. But I think the most compelling thing that comes from this tablet is that Humbaba is not a creature. Like traditionally, he's a giant or some kind of creature, monster, or a host of things. But in this, he's a human being. And so that's, I think, one of the biggest discoveries.
My take on that was that Humbaba was a machine. That seemed to be a better explanation to me.
Well, I've always pictured him as like I don't want to go to Tolkien hardcore here, but like an orc, you know, some kind of giant beast. That's how I always picture. In my mind, you know, some ugly, oversized. What's the word?
Ogre.
Ogre, orc, yeah, I guess that's it, you know. Frankensteinish kind of thing. That's how I always pictured it.
I think I got the machine take from something, and I couldn't quote where, but I think it was Zachariah Sitchin had written something about Gilgamesh, and he'd thrown some tidbits out there, and me being a Stitchinite, I just quote chapter and verse.
That's quite interesting take, though. I think that's fascinating. And in this particular report that they just published, instead of being like a big ogre, they depict him as a foreign ruler that entertained, who's like would entertain with music at a court, and was very much similar to the Babylonian kings, but kind of was painted in a more exotic tone. So his bands and musicians played exotic sounds, and so it was just almost like a different culture, a different, you know, kind of thing. So it's really weird because they go into a lot more colorful detail in the fifth tablet that they found.
Wow. Well, I can't wait to read a complete translation of that. I have another question, if I may.
Yes, go ahead, Mark.
Yeah.
Okay. this concerns Göbekli Tepe and the ancient Armenian culture, and even to some degree the genocide and suppression of the archaeology of Armenia, and then also the linguistic progression that shows that that culture is the culture that moved into the Fertile Crescent. And my question is that with early archaeology being fundamentally funded by fundamentalists, there's a sentence, that they controlled the conversation, they controlled the dialogue, they sent groups to excavate the Holy Lands specifically to prove that the Bible was historically accurate and therefore, you know, backup religion. And so my question is what do you think that the role has been for the Catholic Church in suppressing archaeology as far as this tradition and maybe even suppressing information about the Armenian genocide? Mm-hmm. Do you have any information on that?
Yeah, certainly. Well, you know, I was raised Catholic, and I went to Catholic school and all that and everything. And so, you know, I don't want to start Catholic bashing per se, but I have to say in terms of Vatican, that's a whole nother monster. I mean, that's definitely just another power structure. A lot of these organized religions, and, you know, I don't want to offend anybody when I say this, but, you know, when you get so huge, when you're a powerful organization, you can become corrupt just so easily. Now, we're talking about an organization that's, you know, so old. There's definitely corruption, and we all know there's corruption in the Vatican. But in terms of how they deal with, you know, historic artifacts and things, just think about the fact that they don't even let people study the Vatican archives without just running them through, you know, everything, every which way. They have to have, you know, all kinds of clearance, and they're not allowed to really be there alone, and nobody's touching those archives. I mean, it's a select few people that can even go there. So they definitely have a hold and a handle on, you know, history, and they see the importance of it. So in terms of, like, how effective they could be at implementing such a thing, well, I mean, they have a lot of money, and really money, power, influence. I wouldn't rule it out at all. You know, I don't want to point fingers because I have no evidence to suggest that they are doing anything like that. But I would definitely say, sure, it's within the realm of complete possibility.
Anything else, Mark, before I let you go?
Well, I think that's about it. I'm really interested in the archaeology of Armenia, and I know that's where so much started. So much of our civilization started, and
our language, the language is one of the oldest,
You know, it's a very old language, so it's I think it definitely, if you study linguistics, you know, you'll find Armenian has a huge role in shaping our, you know, current civilization. It's something that, you know, isn't often discussed, but probably should be given more attention.
Yeah, exactly right. Thank you so much, Mark.
Thank you. You guys have a great night.
Thanks, Mark.
So we had on, it's funny that Mark brought that up, but I'm glad that he did. We had Von Setian on the show about a month ago. And one of the things that I had always been fascinated with, but we finally got somebody on, you know, that, you know, it's a PhD and is accredited and has been studying this. He's Armenian. That one of the things that just bothered me and was talked about a lot more off of the air than on is the misconception right now with Göbekli Tepe, because it is referenced as being in Turkey and Turkish. Okay. And it quite simply is not. It's in Turkey now because of a modern boundary, but it's not Turkish. You know,
yeah.
You follow what I'm saying now?
Yeah, that's a great distinction. Absolutely.
It is. And so when you have Turkish archaeologists, you know, bless them for what the work that they do, but if they uncover something, it's Turkish.
That's, right. You know, well, they have strict rules about that too. The idea of, you know, Turkish, what it is to be Turkish. I mean, they have very strict rules about their nationalism, and, you know, they don't have the freedom of speech that we do. So they're very much interested in promoting the idea of being Turkish. And so there's a lot of pride, and rightfully so. Turkey is an amazing place with amazing artifacts and amazing history, but the system of government that they have currently really does promote, you know, the suppression of some maybe broader thinking on those terms and in favor of promoting this concept of being Turkish. So, of course, they would want to, you know, take this and say, this is Turkish. This is Turkish. And so, you know, not giving, you know, like you said, it's not necessarily Turkish. It happens to be in those lines. But these lines are imaginary. There's no, I mean,
right.
Ask any astronaut who looks down at the globe. There are no lines.
Right.
Like the lines that are made by rivers or whatnot, but there are no lines like this. So absolutely.
Yeah. And, you know, modern Turkey, it goes back, those lines, you know, definitely 600 years. Okay. So we can stop there. But before that, for 2000 years, Armenia went from the Black Sea all the way to the Mediterranean. You know, it went from coast to coast to coast. They had three coastlines there. And it touched upon, you know, Persia and the Mesopotamian plains, you know, the Armenian highlands right there where Göbekli Tepe is. That was ancient Armenia. And we can't, it is something that that knowledge, that part of history has been totally suppressed. And certainly Turkey you know, a Turkish archaeologist is not going to uncover something and go, aha, this is Armenian.
It's Armenian, right?
Right.
No, absolutely not. In fact, it could be argued that they would be afraid to do something like that because
course.
There are literal laws on the books against, you know, sort of the idea of being what it means to be Turkish, and so there. Yeah, it's not. It's a very developed country by far. The economy is great and growing, and you know they're very good people. I have so many friends that are Turkish. It's that it's crazy. I love Turkey, but you know the government they have is it could use improvements in that like freedom of speech aspect. So definitely, I think that all the talk about Göbekli Tepe, I think the Armenian aspect of it really does need to be, you know, have a light shine on it a little bit more.
We're going to take a break. Can I get you to hang on for a few more minutes and we'll go into overtime and do a little encore?
Sure.
All
sounds
right.
Great.
All right. Stay right there. Dr. Heather Lynn is with us. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Let's do a little overtime right after this quick break. When we come back, I'm going to ask some stuff that I want to ask, that it's all about me. And we're going to do that right after this. Stay with us.
Jimmy Church on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
But listening to Jimmy Church will.
All right, you fader not. Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fader Not special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52-millimeter main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $59.99 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. That's 70% off a list price of $199.99, and they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net anywhere. Just go to JimmyChurchRadio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
It's not a lifestyle we chose. We were born this way. KGRARadio.com.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Welcome back, Fade to Black. Tonight, Little Overtime with Dr. Heather Lynn. Tomorrow night, Joshua P. Warren and Jay Widener right here. Double feature on Fade to Black. And Wednesday, Alex Teplish and his new book, The Epic of the Anunnaki. Dr. Lynn, I got to read you this quote that Mark from Australia tweeted out. I don't know if you saw it, but he says, "History is a set of lies agreed upon." And that was Napoleon.
Yeah. I used to have that on my website. I love that quote. It's so true.
Oh, man. Exactly.
It's basically working on consensus. That's what history is all about. And many academic fields, you know, it just works on consensus. But, yeah, in a way you could say they're lies, you know, but it depends on how you interpret it. So great quote.
Now, I don't think there is an archaeologist or anthropologist, for that matter, or accredited historian on planet Earth that will go with Graham Hancock and Bovall and some of these alternative views on history. They just won't go there. Do you read Graham? Do you read Bovall?
Yes, I do. I will go there, not on everything, because you can't agree with everybody on everything, but I wouldn't care how many pieces of paper I had stuck on my wall. I'm definitely going to keep reading, independent research, because it's very important. And in a way, it's, within reason. I mean, a lot of people have motives for, you know, writing what they do or however, but it's still a, you know, something that you can say is not necessarily as corrupt as, you know, academia. So not that I have the biggest problem with academia. I know I talk a lot of smack about it, but I'm very grateful to have had the opportunity and so on and so forth. And I think there's a lot of value in it. So kids stay in school, but I got to say, you know, it doesn't take a piece of paper to do good research. It takes a good researcher, critical analysis and understanding sources to be able to, you know, present this information, to look at this information. So I definitely read the works of anybody that has, you know, an opinion. I want to read it. I want to see, because, you know, all ideas are worth considering, I think.
Well, you know, the London Times just slammed Graham Hancock last weekend, the Sunday Times, and really took him to task. And I thought it was violent, and I thought it was wrong. And although I don't want to here have the position of, you know, Graham or Bovall or any of those guys, that their new way of trying to look at things, you can't compare it to, like, well, the earth was flat once, right? And you know, well, I don't want to, you know, go there, but it also is the same. You know, and if we have this closed view of everything, then how do we possibly expand? You know, so what is wrong? I think he should be applauded. He could be, you know, bat dung crazy. He might be, but if we just close the world off, aren't we just closing ourselves in at the same time?
Absolutely. That's very well said. Yes, absolutely. That's exactly what it is. Because, you know, within academia, you'll find people that differ greatly. Like I mentioned before about Göbekli Tepe, a lot of people believe that it's not at all any place of worship, that it's it was a settlement where people just happened to live. And there are other people that say that, this was a place of worship. And so it's not decided. And so even if the, quote, experts, you know, are undecided, if they're undecided, then how is it that the non-experts should take a side and just say, well, you know, it's this or it's that? It's still open for interpretation. It's, if the experts are still interpreting it, then we should be able to interpret it as well. So I just don't think that, people should write everything off. And that doesn't mean everyone should believe everything. It just means that what kind of world would you want to live in if the only thing you get is, like, basically state-sanctioned information? You know, people who, you know, research these things a lot of times are driven by things other than, politics or tenure or profit or whatever. They go in it because they're really looking for an answer. They're looking for something. And so, you know, that's important. I think that's an important motive. And I think that kind of passion shines through in their work. And so it's definitely something that you have to then take a little more seriously and say, well, there's something here. And you know what I find very funny is that, say, amateur archaeologists, they are looked at as somehow just amateur or, like, not credible or something like that.
Inferior.
And I would consider Graham Hancock an amateur archaeologist because, though he may not be actively digging, that's not all archaeology is. It's analysis of this stuff. So, you know, he is doing this. Now, in other fields, say astronomy, you have that notion of being an amateur astronomer. Well, that is sort of, a lot more highly regarded.
It's okay. Yes, it's okay.
It's okay. There have been major discoveries made by amateur astronomers. Yet in this field, it's sort of like no, you have to, have all this and whatever. So that's why I just sort of say, no, forget that. You know, I'm going to read whatever comes my way. I'm going to entertain. I've read some stuff. There's some stuff out there that's like, okay, but even if it's something that you totally don't believe in or want to have no part in, you still have a responsibility to read it. You still have to read it so that you can truly say that you've considered all sources, you've considered all angles, you've done a proper analysis.
You know, I hate to do this, but I'm going to admit this right now. I just stole everything that you just said. I am going to use that as my own.
That's okay. Just cite it. You're fine.
You're going to hear me speaking somewhere in the future. Just sit back and laugh, okay? All right. If I don't give you full credit, you know that.
It's okay.
Yeah, that's my... that is
I'm not
brilliant.
Looking for credit. It's okay.
It's brilliant, though. It's okay to be an amateur astronomer. That is okay. You have a
it's
pass.
It's applauded.
Yeah, you have a hall
pass.
There
have been great discoveries made, absolutely.
Wow, that's deep. Now, that is deep. I stole it. I wrote it down. when you look at, as an archaeologist, when you look at Giza and you hear these 2500 BC references, do you laugh?
Well, I don't necessarily laugh because I understand why it's dated to that degree. But I rather than laugh, I sort of kind of sigh because I think, there's so much evidence to suggest that it's older. And it's credible evidence. But people don't necessarily want to, again, look into these things. So it's just that's why I wouldn't laugh so much as I would sigh, because it's like banging your head against a wall. Like, yes, there's this consensus, but, initially some alternative ideas poke up and they seem very alternative. But then after a while, more evidence can sometimes surface to support it, at which point you have to start saying, well, I have to take a closer look at this. I mean, and so science, technology, all these, things are anything that's based on consensus, basically, is slow to change. You know, some argue that's a good thing, some argue it's a bad. Regardless, it's slow to change. And so I think it's only a matter of time before, you know, ideas of the age, you know, being a lot older, you know, gain more credibility. I think it's only a matter of time.
Well, with Greek calendars and Roman calendars, we can go back so far into the Egyptian timeline where things are pretty precise, you know, but beyond 800 BC, it is nearly pure guesswork. And there isn't anything to accurately time things. So to go back to these, you know, these years of 2500 BC, to me, I think is frustrating, because I don't trust it. And I'm trust, you know, we're asked to put our trust. It's faith, right? Yeah. And that's where I just get a little bit twisted up, because I look at it, it just doesn't look like the other stuff that is around it that we can accurately time, you know, date back to 800 BC or 1000 BC. After that, after 800 BC, it is pure guesswork, and the stuff looks aged to me. It doesn't look like it, the other stuff around. And I'm talking about Luxor and Saqqara and the other sites that you know, it doesn't look right to me. And I think it is pure faith. That's why I just think it is aged, and we have to look at guys like Robert Schock and depend on them for the dating.
Yeah, and you know what? I think it's interesting to point out the hypocrisy here. I think that when you look at, you know, this whole idea of faith, they want to portray, and when I say they, I mean people in positions of authority or science, people who espouse the scientific method, they want you to put faith in them as a researcher, as a scientist, as an institution, as an idea. But there should be no faith in science. Science is the domain of reason and logic and comparative analysis. So what kind of hypocrisy is it that these, quote, scientists want us to just take them at their word, have faith in their work and methods, yet not use our own inherent logic and reasoning to sort these things out for ourselves? And I think that's part of the main problem, all this, the thesis for the evening, is that, you know, we have a responsibility to utilize our critical thinking and our logic and reasoning, and that is what science is. When we use the methodology of the scientific method, you know, that's what that is. It's a methodology. It's not a religion. And a lot of times these scientists are using science as some sort of pseudo-religion and expecting you or us, the collective us, to have faith in them. And that's just plain counter the scientific method. So it's absolute hypocrisy.
Do you think a day will come when Graham is taught in school, or your views are taught in school, or some of these other, I'll say the word again, renegade views are actually taught? Do you have faith in that?
I do. I actually do. I maybe that's a little naive, but I do. And you know when it will be? It'll be when we're long gone and turned to dust, and we won't get the satisfaction. And that's how it always is. So it's going to take a long time for people to, you know, maybe realize. Now, maybe not. I mean, because, you know, honestly, I don't know that I can be so sure of that, because there are so many people rapidly awakening right now. And, you know, in the past 10 years, I've seen it just blow up. And so I think with people's frustration about, you know, this matrix of control that we're under, I think that people are starting to, you know, question these things more and more. And with the ease of availability of these things, I think that, you know, more people are starting to open their minds. So, you know, they're already trying to have Common Core and, you know, all these, you know, sanctioned ways to teach everybody everything from cradle to grave. But I don't think it's going to work necessarily. So, you know, will it be taught someday in schools? Perhaps, and it'll be a long time from now. But does it even need to be? I don't think so. I think that people are waking up enough now, and I think that is more exciting than ever before. We live in great times. Freedom of information.
Well said. What are you working on now?
Oh, wow. Well, Land of the Watchers is coming out next week. It had to have a bit of a pushback here because I actually got contacted by a a law firm from the I guess that represented the oil industry. It was actually a lobbyist group that had a law firm who contacted me, threatened me with all kinds of problems about putting Land of the Watchers out. I had to go back and forth, and it's been a nightmare. I've had unbelievable things happen, and you know, I try not to talk too much about it because it's just stirring up drama. But I got to tell you, there's definitely, you know, people that are worried about this information getting out. And so I had to, you know, figure out a way that I could get it out without truly endangering myself even further. And then also endangering some of my sources, because that became a concern. So that's, you know, kind of wrapped up. So that's going to come out on the 13th. So I'm excited for that. And then, you know, I am working on evil archaeology. And that's just, you know, that's coming along pretty well. I don't have a date for that yet. So I'm still doing some research. I'm working on getting an interview with somebody who's, you know, really, really higher up there in the Catholic Church to, you know, sort of talk to me about the exorcisms and different things. So that's it's a work in progress. So like I said, I don't have a date on that. So I'm just working on things here and there and, you know.
Well, always remember when they interfere, it's because you matter. Always, because
that's a nice way to think of it, huh?
Look, if they didn't care, you know what I mean? They wouldn't care. They wouldn't, you know. And if they want to interfere, it's because you matter. Always look at things that. Now, listen, Renee just sent me an email. She said, "I believe Heather Lynn's last Fade to Black visit was September 30th of last year, just a couple of days over a year ago. Let's not make it a year this time. I had no idea that much time had passed." But
time flies.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Exactly. I can't wait to get you back on. Thank you so much, Heather.
Well, thank you. It's been so fun. I'm so happy to come on because I love the Fader Knots. They're the best ever.
Thank you so much. And again, drheatherlynn.com is the website. All the books are there, cool videos, and just go. It's where
I
go.
Can I say one thing real quick before we go?
You can do whatever you want.
I have a T-shirt. This is crazy, but we're doing a fundraiser for my organization called STAR, the Society for Truth and Archaeological Research.
Oh, is this the
and,
T-shirt? Is
we,
this the
we
T-shirt?
I have a special coupon code for Fader Knots only.
Oh, okay.
It's 25% off if you put in the code FaderKnot2015.
FaderKnot2015. Oh, thank you so much. This is for the T-shirt, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
25% off.
I want one of these. We'll barter. I'll get you a Fade to Black shirt. These are really
cool.
These,
I would love a Fade to Black shirt.
These are really
cool. I would
cool.
wear it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Heather
thank
Lynn,
you.
Everybody. Be safe out there. I'll tweet it out. It's FaderKnot2015.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Dr. Heather Lynn, everybody. Let's take a quick break. I'll be back right after this with the rest of the news that you know nothing about. Dr. Heather Lynn, drheatherlynn.com. FaderKnot 2015. Get yourself the limited edition Follow the Evidence Wherever It May Lead T-shirt. It's right there on the homepage. It's really cool. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Hakimi, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Hi, this is Jimmy Church of Fade to Black. Today, everybody, the Fader Knots and planet Earth is vaping, and I'm very proud to announce our very own e-juice. When we were approached by City of Angels Vapor about Fade to Black e-juice, I wanted to make sure that it was the very best and that the flavors were something that I could create myself. And we did just that. Introducing Fade to Black Fader Loops. This will take you right back to Saturday morning cartoons and your favorite bowl of Fruity Loopy cereal. Just click on the banner or go to www.coavapor.com. Enter the promo code Jimmy for the Fader Not Special. That's www.coavapor.com. Go Beckley Tappy.
Hi, this is Ray Sobbs here repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you. And your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers. We're of the Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
All right, you Fader Not. Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fader Not special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52mm main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $59.99 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. That's 70% off a list price of $199.99, and they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net anywhere. Just go to jimmychurchradio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Tappy.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black. Across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
All right, welcome back, Fade to Black. Thank you, Dr. Heather Lynn. The website is drheatherlynn.com. I just tweeted it out right now. You can use the promo code FaderNot2015, 2015, and get yourself the limited edition t-shirt. It is the Follow the Evidence Wherever It May Lead. It is really cool. It's got the Eye of Horus right there, too. Pretty cool. Go and do it. And it's drheatherlynn.com. I tweeted it out. Go click. Go do it. Support the cause. Thank you, Dr. Heather Lynn. Great conversation. Now, really quick, I want to wrap up with a couple of things. This was just released today. But back on October 2nd, 11 European Union countries, including Austria, Croatia, Cyprus, France, Germany, Greece, Hungary, Latvia, Lithuania, the Netherlands, and Poland, and four regional administrations, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland in the UK, and Belgium, had already formally notified the Commission of their intention to ban GM crop cultivation under the new EU rules. Now, as of today, statements by the governments of five additional countries in form of a more impending notification upcoming. That's Bulgaria, Denmark, Italy, Luxembourg, and Slovenia. No joke, 16 countries, GMO, ixnay. Now, I have to end the show on this. Are you ready? Good news for all of you Fader Nots out there, all of you salted pork product fans. Susanna Mushat Jones, the world's oldest living person at 116 years, has affirmed fate or not hopes and dreams because a profile of Jones from Page Six has revealed that not only does her daily diet consist of morning bacon and eggs, but her niece Lois Judge says she'll eat bacon all day long, end quote. Man, I read that press release today and I just laughed. Totally cool. A team of rocketeers launched an out-of-this-world Kickstarter campaign last Thursday to raise $1 million for Moonspike, an ambitious project they want the first crowd-funded rocket to the moon. The Moonspike project aims to launch a small titanium payload carrying photos and videos from project backers into space and ultimately crash it into the moon. Yes, the resulting dust plume from the impact should be observable from here, its backers say. While a science return from the mission would be desirable, the main goal is to see if a small group of engineers can create a moon rocket and payload for like a reasonable amount of change. That's right. You can go to the Kickstarter campaign right now. It's Moonspike, M-O-O-N-S-P-I-K-E, Moonspike Project. All right, let's see, where am I at? I have one last thing really quick before we go. New research. Okay, this is the ew. Are you ready? I always have one. Here it is tonight. New research should have staggering implications for plastic waste pollution. Okay? An international team of researchers found that the darkling beetle larvae, the mealworm, can subsist on a diet of styrofoam. Yes. And it goes on to say, other forms of polystyrene. In an ongoing worm study, Stanford engineers collaborated with researchers at the University of China and found that microorganisms in the guts of the common mealworm biodegrade styrofoam. The process produces carbon dioxide and a usable waste that appears to be safe for crop use. Yes, in a lab, 100 mealworms ate between 34 and 39 milligrams, the weight of a small pill, of styrofoam per day. The worms converted the plastic into carbon dioxide, and within 24 hours, pooped out the rest as biodegradable fragments that look like rabbit droppings. Styrofoam has long been considered non-biodegradable, and the new results have been described as shocking. This is Fade to Black. I want to thank Dr. Heather Lynn. Tomorrow night, that's right, right here, Joshua P. Warren and his new White House ghost image, and Jay Widener. It's a doubleheader tomorrow night. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Kamarian. Show is produced by Hilton J. Paul, Mark T. Kovar, LJ3, Renee, Mark Dunbar, and Jonas. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vitoe, and Mark D. Kovar. Fady by Dale. Webmaster is Drew the Geek. Music, Doug Aldrich. Intro, Space Boy, spaceboymusic.com. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Game Changer Network. Syndication, KGRA the Planet. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This broadcast is owned and copyrighted 2015 by Fade to Black and the Game Changer Network. It cannot be rebroadcast, downloaded, copied, or used anywhere in the known universe without written permission from Fade to Black or the Game Changer Network. Till tomorrow night, I want everybody to be safe. Go Beckley Tappy.